Foreman is ranked number one in the nation. Marshall is 11th. Marshall won his third straight last Saturday. Quarterback Carl Fodor continued to rewrite the record books with his passing arm. Fodor completed 24 passes for 389 yards. His favorite receiver against Eastern Michigan was Tim Lewis, who pulled down 11 receptions for 156 yards and a score. Lewis and Fodor teamed up for 10 completions in the first half. Defensively, strong safety Mike Copenhaver intercepted two Eastern Michigan passes. Copenhaver's performance was just one shy of tying the single-game Marshall record. Furman shot to the top in the national rankings this week after upsetting North Carolina State 34-30. Furman's led by running backs Robbie Gardner and Dennis Williams. Both are averaging 6 yards a carry. Gardner scored the winning touchdown against North Carolina State. Furman quarterback Bobby Lamb has completed 59% of his passes, and linebacker Rock Hurst leads the team in tackles with 53. For Marshall, it's an opportunity to remain unbeaten and upset the nation's top team.
From Fairfield Stadium in Huntington, West Virginia, WTSF-TV Sports presents Marshall Takes to the Air, Football 84. Tonight, the Marshall Thundering Herd takes on the Paladins of Furman. Tonight's game is brought to you in part by the First Bank of Cerrito.
Hi, everyone, again from Fairfield Stadium. It's a warm evening for football. A capacity crowd is expected for this one, a battle of nationally ranked unbeaten schools in the Southern Conference. Powerful Furman against surprising Marshall. Furman is ranked number one in Division I, 2A after upsetting North Carolina State last week. Marshall is rated 11th after three straight home wins. Marshall has a chance to prove they have turned the corner after two decades of losing football. What a matchup. Furman, number one in the Southern Conference in offense, averaging 434 yards a game. Marshall, number one in defense, allowing 224 yards a game. Marshall, number one in passing, 329 yards a game. Carl Fodor, number one in the Southern Conference in total offense. And the Furman quarterback, Bobby Lamb, the number one man in passing efficiency. It's a great evening for football. Overcast skies, as we said. We anticipate this game. George Connolly had an opportunity to talk to Marshall football coach Stan Parrish.
George Connolly back at Fairfield Stadium once again. And our annual weekly thing, not annual, Stan, because we want this to be a weekly show. And we definitely say welcome, and it's a great thrill to say 3-0, going against the number one team, though, and the first conference game.
Well, it's I don't think you could ask for much more. It's going to be a tough ball game for us, but I have a lot of confidence in our team, and I think the kids are loose and prepared, and you don't get to play number one very often in anything in life, and I think when the opportunity comes by, you got to be willing to lay everything you've got on the line to win that ball game.
Well, Stan, not only with the 3-0 record and the three wins that you have all non-conference, this coming in with your first conference game should certainly be motivational stuff enough to bring your boys alive, plus the number one rating that this Furman team holds.
Well, I have great respect for them, and everything you said is true, and it's what we talked about last winter. Was one of our goals was to be undefeated and play them here in front of what I hope is going to be the biggest crowd that's ever watched a game here, and hopefully we'll play well.
Well, Stan, it is a tremendous thing, and this crowd certainly should appreciate it here tonight. And I know this, that there's been little chance in Huntington, West Virginia, to see two nationally ranked teams. And, partner, good luck.
Thanks very much.
All right, Stan.
Bye now.
Good. And Coach Stan Parrish of the Marshall Thundering Herd now up to Wade Utay.
Thank you very much, George. I'm Wade Utay with Mike Todd and George Conley. And we'll be back at Fairfield Stadium for the coin toss and the opening kickoff in just a moment. Nationally ranked teams, Marshall 3-0, Furman 3-0, Furman number one in the nation, Marshall number 11. And we're getting the flip of the coin.
And I'd like to introduce our other officials. Mr. Buckner will be your line judge, Mr. Irwin your back judge, Mr. Saunders will be your head linesman, and Mr. Brown will be your umpire. Okay, any questions? Okay, Captain. Heads, tails, call in the air, loud and clear, please, so that Mr. Brown can hear it.
Heads.
It's tails, and so, Captain, you win the toss. You can defer or...
We'll take the ball first.
You'll take the ball. Okay. They elect to receive, so you can choose a goal. Okay, want to turn around that way, please? Okay, Captain Harness, you won the toss, and you'll receive at this end. Good luck, fellas. Have a great game.
And the stage is set now. That was Leon Sims and Billy Hines, the co-captains. And Mike Todd, this may not be the biggest game in the history of Fairfield Stadium, but one thing is for sure, it's the greatest opportunity Marshall's ever had in football.
Well, I think, Wade, if you wait for September the 22nd, 1984, to come around, and it has meaning like it does tonight, this is going to be one they're going to write on their calendar for a long time. Stan Perry says that his herd must improve his defense. They had too many missed tackles last week. They've got to tighten that up. But you kind of get this kind of a game going on here, and the Thundering Herd are getting ready to come out on the gridiron now. There's near a capacity house. Not quite. We have a few hundred seats left, but I think the big green is ready, and what better opportunity to play number one? When you play them, you got to get up.
We've almost got a full house as the Herd takes the field, and what a great start for Marshall. Wins over West Virginia Tech, 33-10, Moorhead 46, and a dramatic win over Eastern Michigan University, 24-17, to set the stage for the game of the season against the Furman Paladins. The Paladins have won the Southern Conference Championship 4 years in a row. Marshall has never defeated Furman in football. Furman leads in this series 8-0, and they've dominated the series. There's only been a couple close games. Furman with wins over South Carolina State 28-10 and Newberry 49-7, and then a stunning upset of North Carolina State in Raleigh before 37,000 last week. Furman beat North Carolina State 34-30 on a late touchdown by tailback Robbie Gardner. Furman led on the ground by Dennis Williams and Robbie Gardner. And, of course, the story for Marshall, the great passing arm of Carl Fodor. And not only do we have this tremendous matchup, but we have two Southern Conference Players of the Week. Of course, on the Marshall side, you've got Carl Fodor with that tremendous effort last week. 29 out of 49 for 389 yards against Eastern Michigan. For Furman, number 45, the linebacker, Rock Hurst, Mike, 27 tackles against North Carolina State. That's a season's work.
He must have had radar. All I can tell you about that, Wade, anytime you get 27 tackles in four quarters, you've been every place. That's what it's going to take here tonight for both of these teams. We're going to have to play real hard-nosed defense.
Tom Coker is scheduled to kick off for Furman. He's a sophomore, and Mr. Excitement, Danny Abercrombie, will be deep down the middle, flanked by Surratt and Baxter. Abercrombie is averaging 28 yards a return. He's returned six kickoffs for 169 yards. A couple big returns against Eastern Michigan last week. And so with a near-capacity crowd looking on, anticipating an overflow before this evening is finished, on a rather warm evening, the stage is set for the Southern Conference game. Marshall and Furman, both undefeated, both nationally ranked. Coker kicking off. Number five, Robert Surratt at the five, up the middle. Stays to his feet and gets to about the 21, 22-yard line. It'll be first and 10 for Marshall. One major change offensively because of the injury to starting tackle Steve Wendt. Ray Lamb, a junior out of Ohio, 244 pounds, will open at left tackle. It should be Mike McCoy, the freshman, and Robert Surratt, the senior, as the running backs, with Carl Fodor, Southern Conference Player of the Week. First and 10. We'll call it the 21-yard line opening series. And it's the freshman McCoy for a couple yards. Marshall's running game held in check last week, only 12 yards total, 389 through the air. So when you pass like that, you don't need too much of a running game. But against Furman, they're going to need some help from the running backs.
I thought it was kind of interesting to note in that last offensive play, Wade, that they set four wide out that time and only McCoy back. And, of course, he ran the football. They're going to feel him out a while, and we'll see what happens.
Billy Hindus. Wide to the right, Abercrombie is in the slot. First pass attempt. And it's intended for Surratt. He has caught nine passes, a little bit over his head. Surratt has caught nine passes entering the team for 142 yards. Punt, and he was well short.
You helped create.
Opening series for Furman. Marshall punting a moment ago. Robbie Gardner, number 23, and Deke Williams, number 35, are the running backs. Gardner is the tailback. Bobby Lamb is the quarterback, number 19, on the option. That is Gardner. Breaks a couple tackles and almost broke it for a touchdown. Finally, caught by Garfield Lewis inside the 40. Marshall, of course, trying to contain the explosive running game of Furman.
You've got to see Jerome Hazard there take it out of the play, the defensive end. I think that was the key that really set him loose that time. So that's what you call exceptional downfield blocking, I guess. But it really set up another first down, and here they come again.
It is first down, Furman. Football is at the 37-yard line of Marshall. That's Gardner again off the left side, but the hole plugs up. We see Garfield Lewis and Jeff Warman, the senior from Cincinnati, over there on the right side. 92 was Marty Palazzetti. There he is, Robbie Gardner, junior 200-pounder from Orangeburg, South Carolina. He's averaging 6 yards a carry, 279 yards on the ground, 4 touchdowns, his longest run 26 yards entering this game. Gardner and Dinky Williams, 1-2 punch for a Furman team with a balanced attack and the running game very, very strong. This is second down and needing about 9.5 yards. Nice fake by Lamb. He keeps on the option. Gets a couple yards. Bobby Lamb.
The quarterback.
Marshall had good, pursuit that time. Really, all he did is just roll right out that time and found a little hole, but Marshall reacted very well, and it's second and at about 9.
Third down at seven.
Football is at the 34-yard line of the herd. Another important play early, a big test for Marshall's defense. Third and 7. Split the backs, Lamb going back, big rush, and that was the pressure as blitzing was Jerome Hazard, the freshman from Louisville. Marty Palazzetti also applying pressure. Big play defensively.
No doubt about it, Wade. I really think it probably was the biggest play so far in the first about 4 minutes of the football game. You're going to see the tremendous pressure put on by Hazard and Marty Palazzetti here. And he just threw the ball before he really wanted to do it. And that's exactly what caused the turnover. Now here come the punt.
From midfield, Austin Hamilton, a freshman. High punt. Let's see what happens here. And it's going to be down at the 10-yard line. Austin Hamilton, a freshman, is replacing the regular punter, James Brown, who has an ankle injury. Fine effort by Marshall's defense and the herd. As you can see, the crowd here, and it's a full house.
There's
we'll
a
have
sign.
The football at the 10.
There's a sign down here, Wade, in the north side of the stadium, the Crunch Bunch. And that's the second time it's been up this so far in a young season. And I guess that's exactly what they're becoming to the Marshall faithful at the end. On the 10-yard line, here we go.
Carl Foder sets them up with Abercrombie in the slot on the left side. Sideline pass, Swisher. 22-yard line, Brian Swisher, his second reception. Brian is a young man out of Sistersville, stopped by Robert Little, a sophomore from Greensboro. Watch Swisher.
Here's the second pass completion for Carl Foder. It's for another first down. The Marshall's second of the game, and it sets up a first down on the 21.
Swisher's been averaging 19 yards a reception. Hines wide to the right. Foder on the rollout. Abercrombie, his 16th reception of the season, dropped by linebacker Ben Browder. Abercrombie is third in the Southern Conference in receptions, entering this game with 15 receptions, 176 yards, and 4 touchdowns for Danny Abercrombie. Watch it.
Here's the third pass reception, and look at this. Beautiful, and what can you say? 10 steps, they're a little bit too late. We have an injured player down at about the 16-yard line from Furman. It looks like it's number 56, and that'll be Ben Browder of the linebackers.
Might add, again, checking the injury situation for Marshall, with John Segley, the linebacker, and Steve Wendt, the offensive tackle, both suffering ankle injuries.
You know, Wade Furman lost 16 members from last year's football team that was 10-2-1. And, of course, as you mentioned, they've won this Southern Conference here 4 straight, I think, something like 5 out of 6, whatever. But they are very young. They only have about 9 seniors on the team.
That's number 56, Mitch Gibson, defensive end, a junior who had 21 tackles entering this game out of Charlotte. He'll probably be replaced by a freshman, Sammy Cooper. It is second down and about four for Marshall. We've got about 7 minutes and 40 seconds to go in the first quarter. No score. Full house here. The game. Pass over the middle. That is the freshman, Mike McCoy. Boy, did he take a slap.
He sure did. And Rock Hurst, the young man we were talking about in the pregame show, really, really put a number on him. But it's another first down. And here again, watch this hit that number 45 is going to put on. Now, there it is. Watch this. Here it is. Wham! And boy, you talk about a hello. Eesh.
Some of that determination by Mike McCoy as this Marshall team is ready for this Southern Conference battle. Never have two nationally ranked teams opposed one another here at Fairfield. It's happening tonight. Boy, we're just glad to be a part of it here at Channel 61. Over the middle to Lewis. And it's been the Tim Lewis show through the first three games plus. He was stopped by Browder again. Lewis entering this game, number two in receptions in the conference with 22 receptions, 370 yards, two touchdowns, averaging 17 yards a reception. Last week, 10 catches in the first half against Eastern Michigan. He finished with 12 in the game.
Here's the fourth consecutive completion by Carl Foder. He's thrown four straight. And
here is second and three, and here's a draw play to McCoy. The freshman to the outside shakes off one. We may have a flag as McCoy goes to midfield and Steve Squire catches up with him, a sophomore. And what a tremendous effort by this freshman, Mike McCoy, who took that big hit a moment ago and then rams off the left side. And watch him again.
Just a super, super call that time. Juan Stout opened up a hole. The freshman got over there. You saw the flag. The 48 is going to all be for naught because I guess you could tell by the boos down below it will be against Marshall.
Tough break for the Herd. No score. Less than 7 minutes to go in the first quarter. And
there it is, Quippy.
Carl Foder entering this game now. His three game totals, really remarkable. 67 completions for the Marshall quarterback. Almost 1,000 yards, 963, nine touchdowns. He's even run for two scores. His passing percentage, 56. Second and 10. Ball at the Marshall 33, and let's see, that may be a delay a game call. We'll see what it will be.
Let's mention the officials tonight. Wade quickly down. Sid Harvey, the referee, Larry Brown, the umpire, Claude Saunders, the linesman, Ron Buckner, line judge, Mac Irwin, the back judge.
Now everything's okay. Second down, football at the 33-yard line of the Herd. Second and 10, Carl Foder with McCoy and Surratt behind him. Great catch by Robert Surratt. First down Herd, Robert Surratt, who entered this game, as we mentioned, with nine catches. This senior from Temple Hills, Maryland, remarkable athlete.
Out of the backfield, Robert Surratt again, and I guarantee the Paladins haven't had to defend any type of an aerial show like this through their first three games.
Not only is an outstanding runner, but he's got tremendous hands.
Yeah, he caught that over his right shoulder like a center fielder, no doubt.
What a great play for the Herd, and they've got good field position now at the Furman 46, first down. The draw to the freshman McCoy gets a few yards inside the 45 to about the 44, tripped up by Greg Hall, a junior out of Atlanta, Georgia.
That was exactly the same play they called a moment ago that was called back on the clipping call, but it does keep them honest from time to time. But as we mentioned a moment ago, Carl Foder has now thrown five consecutive completions.
It's second down, second and eight for Marshall at the 44-yard line of Furman with about 5.5 minutes to go, first quarter, and no score. Furman number one, Marshall number 11. Foder, great protection, sets up a screen to Surratt, 45, 40, inside of the 35 and dives to the 31-yard line. Beautifully executed.
Oh. Screenplay. Super, super, super. And let me tell you what, Mike Baracus is the man that set Robert free that time, number 56. And you're going to see it right here. Again, right, it's another first down. And Carl just dumped it over there, and there is Robert. And I don't think you can see Baracus there, but a great, great reception. Another first down, and the crowd is going nuts.
And this full house really has people still coming in. Really coming alive now. It's first down. 31-yard line of Furman. No score. Marshall with great field position on the arm of Carl Foder. Lewis Shakes off a couple tacklers and gets down to the 25. Tim Lewis, sensational tight end, junior out of Clarksburg, entering this game with 22 receptions.
Wade, you're not going to believe this. That's his seventh straight completion, 8 out of 11 so far in the ball game. And here's Tammy Lewis again. We talked about him last week, what a super game he had. And there's so many weapons that Marshall, you can't cover everybody. We have an official timeout here. While we do that, I was going to say that I think we've only had about two or three running plays, haven't we? And that's McCoy a couple of times, I think, and maybe Surratt maybe once, but that's about it.
Such a great matchup here. In total offense in the Southern Conference, you have Furman number one, Marshall number two. In rushing offense in the conference, Furman number one, Marshall last. That's an interesting contrast. In passing offense, Marshall number one, Furman number four. In scoring offense, you have the number one and number two teams. Furman averaging 37 points a game, Marshall 32 points a game. Both undefeated, both nationally ranked. And a capacity crowd and a great night for football. A little bit warm, but sure beats the rain the cold.
It sure does. A lot of people have been waiting for this night to start the Southern Conference to see if the Herd is, in fact, for real. And I think right now, with the first 8 minutes of the first quarter, I believe they're all saying, hey, the Big Green is for real.
This was a football Saturday, and here in the East, I wasn't sure if they should go to a football game or go to the beach today. It was hot.
It was.
Abercrombie and Swisher come out to the right, Lewis to the left, Surratt and McCoy the running backs, second down and four. Fodor rolls right, throws deep into the corner, overshoots Brian Swisher. Tim Stepp, among others, a freshman, defending, and a penalty back around the 29-yard line.
Eddie Abercrombie was so wide open at about the 4-yard line, but the flag was thrown at the 29. Let's find out what it's about here.
Marshall cut down on the penalties last week. They were highly penalized in the first two games, and the penalties can hurt them. That run by Mike McCoy, of course, was eliminated because of a penalty earlier in this quarter.
We'd like to mention, Wade, that Jack Cook's Marshall University baseball team opens up their fall season. They'll play a doubleheader this coming Friday at the new field over at University Heights with Moorhead at 1 o'clock. The University of Kentucky Wildcats at 2 p.m. at Lexington. So four baseball games for Jack Cook's Thundering Herd, and we wish him the best of luck.
And we might mention Marshall's cross-country team beat Kentucky today, and Marshall's volleyball team beat Furman. Tim Bristow is in the backfield now, a sophomore speedster out of North Carolina for Marshall. And Mr. Bristow is not going very far up the middle as he got inside the 30 and then was pushed back. Tim, this season, averaging 4 yards a carry, has carried the ball 11 times for 43 yards.
Little man from Randleman, North Carolina.
Last week, against Eastern Michigan, carried 6 times for 21 yards, and I believe that was tops in the running game. As it will now be, third down, needing 8 for a first down at the 30-yard line of Furman. Third and 8 for Carl Fodor and the Thundering Herd. No score, rather late in the first quarter. Single setback is McCoy. Abercrombie and Swisher to the right, Lewis to the left. Over the middle, Lewis! Twisting and turning to about the 17-yard line. It should be a first down, assuming there's no penalty flag.
I see none anywhere, and it's a 6th first down of the night for Marshall. Look at this again. Carl Fodor is like a computer. He just puts the darn thing up there. Timmy Lewis has got it for the first down on the 17-yard line.
The crowd not only is cheering, they're standing out here. It is now first down for Marshall. At the 17-yard line of Furman, a little over 3 minutes to go, first quarter and no score, both teams undefeated. Marshall's greatest opportunity ever in football. McCoy and Surratt behind Fodor. First down from the 17. Surratt off the right side, gets inside the 15 and drives towards the 14.
That Marshall offensive line we've talked about the last three games has just been simply superb. They're the ones that are keeping Carl Fodor healthy, I'll tell you that right now. And they're opening some good holes once in a while.
They're spotting the football very close to the 14-yard line. It is second down, second about six. Football splitting the 13 and 14 yard line. We'll call it the 13. Split the backs too, McCoy and Surratt on this second down play. Porter rolling left, throwing to the end zone, wide open.
All right.
Touchdown, Danny Abercrombie. And this crowd is going crazy. With a little over 2 minutes to go, as the crowd, as we said, going wild, Marshall has taken a lead over surely a rather stunned Furman football team, 6-0.
Oh, he was wide open. You've got to see Carl again for his ninth consecutive completion. Look at this. In the air all along, and he beat number 42. You saw him going there away in disgust. Him step. And the secondary is having fits with Marshall's receivers.
Scott LaTulip on extra points this year, 11 of 11. He has hit on 39 straight extra points, 25 in a row last year. This one is up. It is good. There's a timeout. It is Marshall 7, Furman nothing. We'll be back for the Marshall kickoff in a moment.
If money is the only thing between you and a college education, then you have a good reason to come over to First Bank of Cerrito. Getting a good education can be very expensive, but having that education is well worth it. That's why First Bank is making student loans. Stop by and pick up your student loan application today. Our loan program applies to out-of-state schools, too. Money for your education. It's another good reason to come over to First Bank. First Bank of Cerrito. Member FDIC.
You'll arrive fresh and ready to cast off in a new full custom conversion van from American Master Coach of Huntington. Ideal for family outings or great for just around town. These custom conversion vans offer comfort and roominess tailored to your individual tastes. They're available with every option, even color TV. Whatever your needs are in a van, American Master Coach can make one to fit.
Danny Abercrombie has just caught his fifth touchdown of the season. And Carl Fodor, what can you say? Last week we thought we'd seen it all, but Carl Fodor comes up against the number one team in the nation and puts on an aerial show.
Doing it encore is sometimes hard, and he's 10 out of 13 here in the first quarter, and we've still got 2 minutes and 15 seconds left to play. You know, Wade, there's a popular song out right now called Ghostbusters, and I think part of the lyrics go, I ain't afraid of no ghost. And I would say Stan Parrish and the Herder ain't afraid of no paladins, I'll tell you.
Brian Jaeger and Greg Smith are the return men. Jaeger is averaging 19 yards return, and Smith 25 on the kickoffs. Smith is number, unless there's been a change, that's the normal alignment. Scott LaTulip will kick off in just a moment now. 2:15 remaining here in the first quarter on the arm of Carl Fodor, who entered this ball game with 963 yards through the air in just 3 games. The Herd taking an early 7-0 lead against unbeaten the Furman, a team that Marshall has never beaten in football. Number 34, Jaeger, 20, down the sidelines, tripped up across the 30, does a flip to about the 32 by Todd Brown. Brian Jaeger, who's been averaging 19 yards in return.
Number 72, Chuck Davidson of Furman, really put a block on one of the Marshall defenders coming down the field. They had opened up that big hole. So really, they say when you get over the 30-yard line, you've got great, great field position, and that's exactly where they're at, about the 32. Now watch this. He just gets tripped up here with Todd Brown, and that's really saved almost a touchdown.
First down, Furman trailing in this game. Remember, last week, this Furman team upset North Carolina State before 37,000, and Raleigh and Robbie Gardner trying to wedge out a few yards. Defensively again up front, the defensive ends for Marshall. Marty Palazzetti, number 92, and Darrell Johnson, 86. The tackle, 71, Jeff Foreman, and number 98, Alan Huff. The nose guard, number 78, the senior from Arizona, Ethan Fields. The linebackers, number 48, Tony Lely, and number 89, John Logan. And it looks like a penalty is going against the Paladins this time, Mike.
It is a legal procedure. It'll set it back 5 yards and set up a first and 15 on the Furman 27-yard line.
The quarterback is Bobby Lamb, Robbie Gardner, and Dinky Williams are the running backs, both averaging 6 yards a carry this season. That's the fullback, Dinky Williams, off the right side, and not too much room. Gets out to about the 30-yard line. Jerome Hazard, a freshman from Louisville, linebacker in high school, getting his first start, and boy, he is really putting on a show.
He also had a lot of help out of 89, John Logan, the linebacker there. Those two guys, in fact, it's just gang tackling out there. Gardner slanting off the right side that last run.
It's no secret, Marshall must stop the running game of Furman, and so far, they've done a heck of a job. Now to the outside goes Fox on the reverse, and he's not going anywhere. Chaz Fox has carried a couple times, including a touchdown. Mike Copenhaver bumped him out of bounds. He's a senior wide receiver, but that time they watched him and contained him pretty well.
Yeah, you see the old end around, and I love the lateral pursuit that the Marshall Big Green has had. They really just play the football when they have to. And listen to this crowd. The crowd is in it, no doubt about it. Listen.
At the Pasadena House, it is 3rd and 8 at the Furman 35. Lamb, the number one. Here's a flag being dropped.
81 lined up offside.
Indication it would go against the Paladins. And it's being declined by Marshall.
Again, illegal procedure. We'll set it back again now to the 29, make it to 30-yard line, and that's two big penalties in this drive for the Paladins.
3rd and 13 from the 30-yard line. Kirk Burnett is in the ball game as a wide receiver. Lamb needing long, and he is throwing deep to Fox over his head. The speedster, Chaz Fox. Leon Sims trying to stay up with him. And it's now 4th down. Look at this crowd.
Well, the defense again getting another standing ovation. And the people here in Huntington love the Big Green now. It sets up a 4th and 13 with a minute 7 to go. And the Paladins will have to punt it away.
Well, it's an historic evening in Marshall football history. And Marshall has played a whale of a first quarter. Hamilton, the freshman, back to punt. Big rush. Not too long. I believe a fair catch by Lewis, and pretty good field position now for Marshall. The regular punter, James Brown, has an ankle injury. That is not a strong point of the Furman attack. So Marshall with good field position at the 32-yard line, and you might say the crowd is into this game now.
You know, they say, you know, emotion is a big part of football, and I think more tonight than it ever has been here at Fairfield Stadium for a school by the name of Marshall University. They have really put the word to its literal use. The emotion is what they're playing on right now.
First down at the Marshall 32. Carl Foder, he finds Abercrombie. Not a first down, but another completion. This series, as we said, dominated by Furman. Marshall has never beaten the Paladins. There's only been one close game in the last 7. The last 4 have all been one-sided. 35-0, 35-3, 45-7, 31-7. It's been all Furman.
And that totals up to 282-90, if you're interested. You didn't know I knew that.
I don't think Marshall is.
No.
Second down play. Look at the protection for Foder.
Look at this.
Oh, Surratt couldn't hold on to it. Robert Surratt.
Well, Robert Surratt, as Wade said, was up and around the 49-yard line, and it would have been a completion, of course, had he held on. The defenders were beaten, no doubt, but it stopped the clock with 18 seconds left and 3rd down and 6.
Last year, by the way, referring to Robert Surratt, he scored the only touchdown in the game for Marshall, went 3 yards in the 4th quarter to avoid a shutout as Furman won that game 31-7. This Furman team has dominated the Southern Conference with 4 straight conference titles under Dick Sheridan, 52-18-2 overall. And here is 3rd down and about 6 for Marshall from the 36.
Did he
what
get
a
it?
Catch by
yes,
Brian
he did.
Fisher. 1st down as Carl Foder comes up with another spectacular play. And there's Brian Swisher, the young man out of Sistersville, 5'8", 142-pounder. Watch this catch.
Just simply, look at that beautiful outstretched hands, and Carl Fodor putting it right on the money. And I used the word a minute ago, Wade. It's almost like a computer. His accuracy is outstanding now, and he just continues. I can't believe that he's got this great accuracy.
So in the closing seconds of the first quarter, on a hot evening, Marshall is sizzling. 7-0 Herd, first down from the 36-yard line of Furman. Look, it's a protection. It's unbelievable.
No way, not an interception.
Number 31, Jerome Norris, who has two interceptions already this season, a sophomore, thought he had it. Fodor is getting tremendous time. The offensive line, Ray Lamb, Mike Barakas, Juan Stout, Steve Staley, and Rob Bowers doing some kind of job.
They're the guys that are making it happen. And, of course, number 31 there, you look at Jerome Norris. He'd love to have that one back, I'm sure. But it is an incompleted pass, and it stops the clock down with 6 seconds.
Marshall leading 7-0. Touchdown pass to Danny Abercrombie of some 14 yards. And now it is second down and 10 at the Furman 36. And again, throwing deep over the middle. Tremendous reception by Brian Swisher in traffic. Inside of the 20-yard line at about the 18-yard line of the Paladins. And what a first quarter for Marshall. They've done it all here in the first quarter. And this crowd really going wild. That is the end of the first quarter. Marshall 7, Furman nothing. Watch this last play in the quarter. What a reception by Swisher. At the end of the quarter, Marshall 7, Furman nothing. Be back for the second quarter in just a moment.
What would you call a zenith that puts a 25-inch picture in a 19-inch space?
Smart, yes, smart.
And for continuous color balance, a computer brain.
A brain is smart.
Plus parental control that locks out channels you don't want.
Now that's smart.
The Smart Sets. Advanced System 3 from Zenith. When you want everything.
Honey to burn and winter's cold. Is your concern? Cook's Farm Center helps you keep what you earn. Save your butt on a bus stove.
Tired of high heating costs? Buck Stoves can save you up to 80% on home heating bills. Don't turn your thermostat down when heating costs get too high. Turn it off and let an efficient Buck Stove keep you warm and cozy.
Cook's Farm Center.
Welcome back to Fairfield Stadium. Wait, you'd say Mike Todd and George Conley and the Stan Parrish Aerial Circus continuing here before this capacity crowd. Number one Furman, surely stunned by this passing game of Marshall.
I think you got to give Stan Parrish credit, Wade, because he's the guy that is making this thing work. He has these kids believing they can do it. He said they would win this football game. And they're on their way to doing it. They lead it 7-0 down. We're about ready to begin the second quarter. And we said a few hundred seats a moment ago at the outset were remaining. They are now gone. And it is standing room only here at Fairfield.
The all-time crowd, 18,212 in 1981 against Morehead State, of course. They lost some seats because the stands on the far side were demolished and temporary or permanent bleachers installed. So we'll just have to wait for the final count. But it's got to be nearing the 18,000 mark tonight. It is an unbelievable night for Marshall football. You'd have to go back at least 20 years for anything close to this, and it may be the biggest night ever for Marshall football before it's all over. Surratt, and man, he just digs for extra yardage. What a great effort. Robert Surratt inside the 15 to about the 14, and that's the determination this entire Marshall team has been showing through the first half.
Well, I mentioned it a moment ago, Wade. It's called emotion, and he was stopped at about the 16-17-yard line with a great second effort, plunged his way over the 15 and down to about possibly the 14-yard line. Fodor was 13 out of 17 in the first quarter. Incredible.
Second down, Marshall at the 14-yard line of Furman. Marshall is leading Furman 7-0 early second quarter. And here is a swing pass to Surratt, incomplete.
Intended for Surratt.
Yeah, that was Robert coming out of the backfield, as Wade said, a little old swing pass that I think maybe you've got about 5-6 yards out of the thing if you could have caught it.
It'll be third down for Marshall, 14-yard line of Furman, needing six. Swisher checks in. Entering this game, Porter had set 5 single-game records this season for pass attempts, 49, pass completions, 29, passing yardage, 389, total offense, 365, touchdown passes in one game. Third down, needing 6, 14-yard line of Furman, early second quarter, Marshall leading 7-0. Porter with time, throws to the end zone, deflected, almost caught by Abercrombie. Good defensive work by the Paladins as Robert Little, a sophomore from Greensboro, saved the touchdown.
Well, Brian Swisher was, of course, open, but he was not the intended receiver. But here again, you look at it in the end zone, and a beautiful defensive play, and that's all you can say about that. Denied number 27, the football.
Scott LaTulip in for a field goal attempt. This year, 4 of 8. He's kicked from 22, 35, 28, 37 with success. And this one will be spotted around the 21, an effort of 31 yards by LaTulip, the senior. A 31-yard attempt. It's going to be blocked. It will be Furman's football near the 40-yard line. Jerome Norris in there. And a big turnaround on the Furman side.
Well, that's exactly what Furman would love to do right now. They've got to get the momentum back their way. Marshall had the football 9 minutes and 9 seconds in the first quarter. Furman had it 5:51. So Marshall really kind of had their way in the first quarter, scoring a touchdown. And Furman right now, they're like nothing better than say, hey, we're not going to take this pushing around. You're going to have to take some things our way now. And Bobby Lamb's going to come out of there. Here's a guy that's got 60% completion. It's Bobby Lamb, number 19.
First down, Paladins, and that quieted this capacity crowd. Football at the 38-yard line of Furman. To the air, complete to Fox. Chaz Fox near midfield. He's a senior speedster from South Dakota. Had caught 5 passes for 2 touchdowns entering this game. He was dropped by Tony Lally. First down.
As you said, it is for the first down. That's their third of the football game. A very big contrast to the passing game. Marshall has passed 19 times, Furman 4.
So a test now for the Marshall defense after that block punt. Furman, of course, now they've got some momentum. First down, 49-yard line. On the pitch out, that is Gardner. Boy, look at the effort by Gardner. He's got a first down. That's Robbie Gardner exploding off the left side. Gardner, who's averaging 6 yards a carry, number 2 in the Southern Conference.
Well, Gardner that time got some outside blocking, and the key to that was the 2 people over on the around the sidelines that opened the hole for him. And, of course, if the hole's there, that young man is going to scoot, I'll tell you.
Gardner scored the winning touchdown late in the game, going 6 yards against North Carolina State in the big upset last Saturday. And so it's now first down and good field position for Furman. 36-yard line of the herd. To the deep back, Gardner. Or Jager. Let's make that Brian Jager has replaced Gardner. Jager's a sophomore, 5'10", 175 pounds out of Georgia. He's been averaging 5 yards a carry. Jager gets a good gain. It's now second down and about 2.
Well, Furman right now, I think, Wade, is, as you can see it here, just establishing their running game, and that's exactly what they want to do. That's their strong point, and they're going to do it, and Marshall's going to have to say no right about here.
There's a new fullback in the lineup, John Dry, number 30, a junior. I believe that's Dry and Gardner, the running backs. Lamb fakes, rolls right, passes, and maybe, no, incomplete. Kirk Burnett almost had it. Ball goes incomplete, and let's credit Garfield Lewis and that Marshall defensive secondary.
Garfield was there, and he darn near had the football. Now, again, you see Lamb coming out of there, rolling out of the pocket, spots his man, and you see Garfield just about had his fingers on it, and probably was very responsible for making the thing incomplete.
Now it becomes third down for Furman, needing 2 for a first down at the 28-yard line of Marshall. Still early in the second quarter with Marshall leading Furman 7-0. High formation. Beautiful fake. That's Lamb. And that should be plenty for a first down to about the Marshall 22. Bobby Lamb stopped by Lewis. Lamb is just a junior. As Mike said, he's completed about 60% of his passes. And last week, he was sensational against North Carolina State.
He usually through the game, through the passing department, Wade, knocks out about 147 yards a game.
It is first down, Furman. They're driving for the go-ahead touchdown, or rather at least tying touchdown. It's first and 10 from the 23-yard line of Marshall. Gardner off the left side. Dragged down about the 15-yard line. Darryl Johnson starting a defensive end on the right side. Sophomore out of Louisville making the stop.
Well, that Furman line right now is opening up some gigantic holes in there. And this is, Marshall's not had this type of, I think, challenge, anything like they had last week. But let's see what they can do here.
Fox is wide to the right. Second down, Furman, needing three at the 16-yard line of Marshall. Marshall leads 7-0. That's the tailback, Gardner, off the left side. He stays to his feet. There's a fumble, I believe, over there around the 4-5. And Marshall has the football. What a break for the herd. It looked like a sure touchdown. Gardner broke loose. I hope we get a chance to see the replay. That was a dramatic play.
It sure was. And now you talked about taking the wind out of your sails. Here's Lamb now. And Gardner's going to get the football. There he gets just that's a good move right there, Mike Copenhaver. Going down, he just lost the football. Right about the 5-yard line, it slipped out of his hand.
Well, that's got to be the biggest play so far, and what a tremendous break for the herd on what looked like a sure touchdown for Furman. Marshall leading 7-0, closing in on the 11-minute mark of the second quarter, and the crowd is on the edge of their seat. From the 4-yard line. First down, Marshall. McCoy off the right side. Robbie Gardner coming off a dramatic performance against North Carolina State. Shaking off attack for a moment ago, fumbling the football. And what a turnover for the herd.
It sets up a second down at about 8.
Billy Hines checks in. Dick Sheridan, the head coach, his seventh year at Furman. In the Southern Conference, his record, 32 wins, 7 losses and a tie, 5 conference titles in 6 years. Here's second down, needing about 9 for a first down. Surratt, that's a place you cannot afford to make a mistake. And now it'll be third down.
Well, of course, right here, Wade, people may be wondering why Marshall's staying on the ground right now. Of course, if he goes back into the pocket, he's going to be right on the goal line, and if he's dumped, you know what that is. So it sets up a third down and 9. They lost about a yard on that play. There's 10 minutes and 6 seconds left here in the first half. It's Marshall 7 and Furman nothing at this point.
Marshall has a fine punter in Mike Salmons, and this is a third down play. Wouldn't be surprised if they throw.
Nope.
A little bit more conservative, and you can't blame them, Robert Surratt, and that will put the pressure on the specialty team and, of course, on a young man by the name of Mike Salmons, who's been averaging 42 yards a punt, as long as 56, 13 punts going into this game, and back to receive, Chaz Fox, who's been averaging 20 yards a return on punts, along with Jerome Norris. Fox is number 20. Salmons about as far as he can get into that end zone. Big rush, short punt, fair catch, 31, Norris, about the 31-32. I thought for a moment that was going to be blocked.
I did too, but Furman has excellent field position now at the 33-yard line that they'll set up right there with the first and 10 with 9-10 to go.
One of the few times, referring back to that last series, and of course, we can't blame Stan Parrish. One of the few times that Marshall offensively played it very conservative.
Exactly. The entire series, 3 consecutive downs, and they ran it 3 times, but you can't blame him. We said it was on the 4-yard line or 5.
But that puts the pressure right back on the defense with over 9 minutes to go here in the second quarter. Lamb brings him out from the 32-yard line, first and 10. That's Jaeger.
Oh.
Stays to his feet. Still stays to his feet.
Super
tremendous run by Ryan Jaeger all the way down to the 20-yard line, the sophomore. He's the backup to Robbie Gardner, averaging 5 yards a carry. Ryan Jaeger with the termination.
Here's a young man out of Georgia now. You talked about just punches. He gets hit about 5 times. There's 1. There's 2. There's 3. There's 4. 4 times he got hit, and he got a a first down out of it.
First and 10 for Furman, knocking on the door again. Football at the Marshall 20. Box is wide to the right. Number 35, Dinky Williams, the senior fullback, gets inside the 15 to almost the 11-yard line of the Herd. Approaching the midway point of the second period, Furman knocking on the door again. A fumble a moment ago wiped out a possible Paladin score. Now they've got it right back again. From the 11-yard line. Second and two for a first down. 11 for a touchdown. Jaeger off the left side. Slices, twisting and turning near the 5-yard line before Garfield Lewis pushes him out of bounds. But Brian Jaeger, who has filled in here for Robbie Gardner, is really running with determination.
Something about him, Wade, he really has determination in his blood, and you can see why Furman, of course, is rated number one in the country. And I'll tell you one thing. They have a tremendous running game. These guys are not only big and strong, but they're so doggone agile.
Go to go now. First down for Furman at the 6-yard line of Marshall. Bobby Lamb directing the attack. That is a Furman touchdown. Dinky Williams, his first touchdown of the season. He had been averaging 6 yards a carry, 190 yards total going into the game. And the junior from Anderson, South Carolina, has made it a 7-6 ball game as that block punt, as we go back to that block punt, really set this all up.
Just good power running by number 35, Dennis Williams, the fullback. And we have a 7-6 game, as Wade says. It was a very important extra point.
Kevin Esball, a junior, place kicker. He has split the middle, and so there's a timeout midway through the second quarter. It is now Furman 7, Marshall 7. We'll be back with the Furman kickoff in a moment.
Name a nationally known paint that's now at Hex. A quality paint that spreads on smooth as satin, dries in 30 minutes, cleans up quickly with water, and is priced low every day. Introducing Glidden Paints, now at Hex. You'll find famous spread satin for your walls, Glidden's best quality spread house paint for exterior surfaces, and the rest of Glidden's complete line of quality paints, now at all Hex locations.
To Fairfield Stadium. It's a 7-7 ball game. Again, you have to go back to that block punt, even though Furman didn't score right after the punt. It still pushed the pressure on the Herd. They couldn't get out of the hole, and then, of course, eventually that short punt. And Marshall, of course, again on the defense after they punted, and Furman drove it about 31 yards. So, again, the big turnover makes a world of a difference.
You know, good teams make their breaks a lot of times, Wade, and I think that's exactly what happened here with Furman, of course, coming back after that fumble over there, and just not, the very, very, I guess to use a good word, resilient, I think that's a good word, but they just bounced right back and weren't intimidated at all by Marshall. So we'll see what Marshall's made out of now. They're going to have to come back and say, hey, we didn't win 3-0 sitting down. See what they can do.
They sure just didn't have the right pot.
Tom Coker, a sophomore, will be kicking off for Furman. Here's Abercrombie at the 5, the 20, 30, 31-yard line. A flag has been dropped back about the 22-yard line. We'll see if that's going to be called back as Danny Abercrombie, who have been averaging 28 yards of return on kickoffs, but a penalty, I believe, is going to cost the Herd dearly here. He can see that they're marking the football back towards the 10-yard line. So Marshall forced to play a conservative brand of football on the last series. So they had to work from inside the five and then punt it out and run and scored. Now they'll have no choice. They're going to have to open up here, even though they're back at the 10-yard line. The score now tied.
Yeah, they're only about 5 yards better off than they were a few moments ago.
Costly penalty. And now Folder on the rollout will go to the air. Abercrombie near the 20. Danny Abercrombie, who has caught the one touchdown pass for Marshall, pulls this one in. As Tim Bristow checks in the lineup for the herd, it'll be second down and about two. Bristow replacing Surratt.
Here again, it's been a while since we've had a completion for Marshall, but it did set up a second and two down, 8-yard completion, and he gets them a little bit out of the hole weight.
Football now at the Marshall 19. The score is tied, second period. Deflected pass, and wow, almost intercepted there. Gerard Smith crashing through, senior defensive end. And this Furman defense starting to, as we can see there, obviously starting to put the pressure on Carl Folder.
Yeah, they really built up the intensity in the last couple of minutes, Wade. You can see it after you know, that fumble a moment ago. They were very, very determined to come back and to get the touchdown, and now they want the football very, very bad. And with a third and two, let's see what Marshall can do.
From the 19-yard line, Marshall needs to maintain possession. We've got 7 minutes or so remaining here in the first half. Folder, he has time. He's going deep. It's picked off. That is Steve Squire, midfield, 45-40. And near the 35-yard line, Squire picks it off. And a big, big turnover again. We had the block punt, which eventually resulted in a Furman touchdown. And now the interception on a pass that definitely was off the mark.
Yes, it was. And I guess if you had to put something, it was off the target. And Squire was back there playing center field, and he just picked the doggone thing off out of midair. And after he got it, he ran the darn thing back about 25 yards. So, again, Furman has the football. We've got a personal foul. We'll be assessed against Marshall. And it's going to be a foul occurred at about the 37-yard line. They're going to move it back now. This is going to be another very, very costly penalty here. It's going to set Furman up knocking on the door again.
Combination now of penalties and turnovers here in the second quarter.
Marshall's becoming their own worst enemy, Wade. That's about the way you can put it.
First and 10, Furman, 21 yards away from taking the lead here in the second quarter. Fox wide to the right. Stay with the eye. Williams right up the middle, tripped up at the 10. Looked for a moment like he was going to go the 21.
Well, you got Jim Edmondson there, Andrew Bernstein. These are the guys on the line right now, opening up the hole for people that they could run through it like Dink Williams a moment ago. And that has really been the key to them establishing their running game. They have been just doing about what they want to do.
First down. That's Williams again. That time, Marshall's defense lugs it up. I had referred the block punt. Of course, that was a block field goal that playing such a big factor here in the second quarter.
It sure did. Furman has 8 first downs in the football game to Marshall 7 at this point. If you're just joining us here on TV 61, it is 7 for Marshall, 7 for Furman. And Furman's knocking on the door at about the 8-yard line.
Second down. 8 for a first down. 9 for a touchdown. That's Gardner, right side, inside the 5 to about the 4. John Logan leads the defensive charge. He just joined us. Marshall took the early lead, dominated the first quarter. But the second quarter, watch it again.
There's Gardner, a guy that, well, just about every time he runs it, Wade, he gets about 6 yards so far in the 3 games they've played. I can see why.
Second quarter's been dominated by Furman, as Furman now facing third down, needing 4 for a first down and touchdown, apparently. Gardner, right side.
He didn't make it.
Just short of the mark. Right around the one-yard line. Going to be fourth down, and here's a key play in this first half. With the score tied, fourth down, football is just outside the one-yard line. We'll call it the two. You can see it.
What a crowd.
Play this one is, and this crowd really coming along. Williams and Gardner in the backfield. They'll probably re-huddle here. Officials take a timeout. They're going to say, if you just joined us, with the score 7-0, Marshall trying to add to that lead, and Scott LaTulip trying the field goal. It was blocked, and then since then, it's been all Furman. They've scored, and they've gotten the ball back again. Here we go, inside the two. Fourth down. A little less than 2 yards needed for a touchdown, and this crowd giving Bobby Lamb fits. He can't get a signal call off here. And this, of course, is what Stan Parrish wanted. He wanted a big crowd. He wanted that emotional lift. And I think he's gotten it tonight. Furman's just having trouble getting a playoff. That didn't help when the public address announcer said, please be quiet.
Yeah. PA announcer here at Fairfield had told the crowd, as Wade said, to hush up a little bit. The crowd doesn't like that. Here we go now. Let's see it.
Fourth down. Less than 2 yards for a touchdown. Right side. And that's an easy touchdown. That is Robbie Gardner. Gardner now scores. That's his fifth touchdown of the season off the right side. And Furman has the lead for the first time in the game, 13-7, as Kevin Espaul, the junior, tries to add the extra point. He entered this game with 13 of 14 extra points this season. Extra point is good. Timeout on the field. It is now Furman 14, Marshall 7. A little over 4 minutes to go in the first half. We'll be back at Fairfield Stadium in a moment.
And I think somewhere around that fumble, Wade, they were very, very determined young men. They weren't going to be denied the TD. They came back and scored. They got the football back for Marshall a moment ago. And Gardner is now showing why he's one of the best runners in the country.
A blocked field goal in the second quarter, turning things around. And it's been Furman with all the momentum since then. After Marshall dominated the first quarter with a super effort of quarterback Carl Fodor, really dissecting the Furman secondary, but the combination of a break, the momentum, the pass rush by Furman, everything has gone the Paladins' way, and right now they're living up to their number one ranking in the nation. We've got a lot of football ahead. It's 14-7. And it's still plenty of time for Marshall here in the first half, with over 4 minutes to go, especially with Carl Fodor and that strong right arm. Tom Coker will boot it. Daddy Abercrombie, about 2 yards deep in the end zone, averaging, of course, 28 yards a return. Surratt down the sideline, shaking off one tackler, and gives Marshall good field position up around the 35, and for a change, the Herd will have a little operating room.
That has been what they've been lacking the last couple of times they've had the football. They haven't really been able to do what their strength is and throw the football and open the offense up like they've been capable of doing and have been in the last couple of weeks. And now they have the football on the 35. Here's Robert Surratt. You're going to see him bounce off of the guy right there. Watch that. He's bounced off, came back, broke a tackle here. He's up over the 30 to the 35, and as you said, Wade, they're set up pretty good right here.
First down, Herd, from the 36, Fodor. Completion, 50, Swisher out of bounds, and the Herd needed that, and they're getting an emotional lift, not only offensively, but from this crowd again, with still a lot of time to go. here in the first half. We've got 4 minutes to go, and Marshall with good field position. That football now is up around the 48-yard line. First down, Hurd.
Here it is again. You're going to see this completion by Bryant. He just breaks a tackle here. Kind of steps out of bounds at about the 45, but Marshall threw the football 17 times in the first quarter, only five here in the second so far.
Swisher has had an excellent first half. First down, Hurd. Short of midfield. Boy, right on target to Billy Hines out of Huntington High School. The senior, his eighth reception. Hines has a Marshall first down, and the ball's going to be marked at the 37-yard line as Brian Swisher checks back in, alternating with Billy Hines, and that's quite a duo, too.
Well, Bill makes things happen when he comes in, and he had a very key reception there. It sets the football on the 37-yard line of Furman. Marshall now going to their strength, being able to do what they can do best, and that is throw the football.
Abercrombie in the slot on the right side. First down from the Furman 37. Surratt trying to reach the 30-yard line. Brock Hurst, the Southern Conference Player of the Week, with 27 tackles against North Carolina State, making the tackle. Number 45. Hines checks back in for Marshall. Tim Lewis caught 12 passes last week, and boy, you know that the Paladins are really putting the coverage on Lewis in this one. But that opens somebody. It's been Swisher for the most part. Swisher's to the left this time. This is a second down. Porter going deep. Abercrombie, and it's knocked away and almost intercepted as Jerome Norris, who has two interceptions, a sophomore, almost came down with it.
He sure did, and it's a good thing for Marshall. It stopped the clock now with about 2:55 to go, and we're going to look at it again. This ball was pretty good, throw pretty good, and you're going to see the Norris just come right in there and jump up in the air, and he says, oh, I'd like to have that back. Good defensive play, and it's as he said, it's third down and four.
Football at the Furman 31. Late now in the first half, Furman leading 14-7. Third and four at the 31 of Furman. Split the backfield. Boder with time over the middle. And is it intercepted? I believe it is by Ben Browder. Looks like it was in and out of the arms of McCoy, and Ben Browder with a sensational interception.
It is, and it's exactly the adjective you'd have to use on this. Now, you're going to see Mike have the football, and he's bobbling the thing, and there's Browder right there being the opportunist of the day. Look what I found.
I think that summed up the second quarter, as it's been all Furman, as Ben Browder, who entered this ball game with 27 tackles through three games, a senior from Charlotte, one of the linebackers with Rock Hurst, coming up with another key turnover, and now Furman with time. Dry is the fullback out of the eye. Furman leading 14-7, land to the air. He's got time. He's going deep. Fox. Fox has it. 25-yard line. The explosive Chaz Fox, the senior. Leon Sims saved the touchdown. Fox, the wide receiver, had entered this game with five receptions and two touchdowns. Big play as Bobby Lamb shows why he is such an outstanding quarterback and the number one passer as far as passing efficiency is concerned in the Southern Conference. First down at the Marshall 26. Some movement on that left side. Jager stopped in the backfield. Marty Palazzetti, defensive end, senior from Michigan, number three tackler on the team with 10 solo and 14 assists.
You know, Bobby Lamb, I think Wade, besides being a very, you know, accurate quarterback, of course, we talked about that, he's also very deceptive. And his handoffs are very, very smooth. And Marshall's reacting, though.
He runs the option beautifully. Here is a second and 10 from the 26-yard line of the Hurd. It's really important Marshall stops the Furman attack here. He's pressured, and he comes out of it with a fine run inside the 20, down to about the 19. Lamb under pressure, but shows he can do a little scrambling.
The intended receiver was Jeff Lee, the tight end, number 85, and he was covered like glue by Jerome Hazard down there, and that's exactly what caused him to scramble out of the pocket here. Now, he's looking, see. He said, uh-oh, I better get out of here. And by that time, it's just run for your life, and you can see what happened.
Sean Finnan, a freshman, is in at the nose guard right now for the Herd. There's been a timeout on the field here with Marshall leading, or rather trailing here, 14-7. So with a timeout, we'll be back at Fairfield Stadium in just a moment. His defense. Little mix up there. Jaeger is in the backfield. Lamb with plenty of time. That is a Furman touchdown to number 20, Chaz Fox, the senior, as Bobby Lamb had plenty of time to find Fox crossing over into the end zone. And again, a big turnover, this time as it was an interception. And there's the touchdown pass to Fox. Furman has turned two turnovers, a blocked field goal attempt, an interception in the touchdowns. Here is Espaul. The extra point is good again. So with a little over a minute to go here in the first half, it is now Furman 21, Marshall 7. We'll return with the Furman kickoff in a moment.
It's Microwave Madness at Big Sandy Furniture through Sunday. Big Sandy has over 1,000 microwaves priced to sell fast, including the famous...
As you say, Chaz Fox a moment ago, a great... Here's a look at it again. Now, Fox is running a crossing pattern. That's Leon Sims right behind him there, and he beat Leon twice now. I'm sure Leon's not going to let that happen much more.
Chaz Fox out of Rapid City, South Dakota. He has been a spark here for the Paladins, who have scored twice on the ground and once through the air, taking advantage of the breaks. And after Marshall had dominated the first quarter, it's been all Paladins, and Marshall will have to regroup at halftime. The score is 21-7. This game is far from over.
I think it's been a good first half, Wade, really, exception of the turnovers and the penalties that have hit Marshall, but like you said, there's a lot of time left and a lot of football, and I'm sure these people here will be right here rooting them on for the second half.
Again, Tom Coker, the sophomore, will do the kicking. And here is Danny Abercrombie at the goal line. He's at the 20 and maybe to the 22-yard line. Abercrombie out of Coldwell Jr., 5'9", 175-pounder. And entered this game with six kickoff returns for an average of 28 a return. With around a minute and a half to go, you know, that's enough time for Carl Folder, but Carl has really struggled. That last time, though, a bad break as it was in and out of the arms of Mike McCoy. And again, Mike McCoy cannot hold on to it, the freshman out of Parkersburg. And let's give that Furman defense some credit, too.
Yeah, he was covered real well. There were three white shirts around him there. And we have a flag on the play, though, however, Wade. And got to call interference, I think it is. Illegal use of the hands against Marshall.
Everything that could go wrong has just about gone wrong here in the second quarter.
It certainly has, and you'll have to go, well, I guess when you've heard the saying, you got to go back to the drawing board, and that's exactly what they're going to have to do at halftime, and correct these mistakes, and simply, you know, do things right the second half. They've been their own worst enemy.
So they decline the penalty, and that means it'll be second down, second and 10 for Marshall at the Herd 22. Minus wide to the right, Abercrombie in the slot. Little draw to McCoy. He's got some room. Hey, super run by the freshman, Mike McCoy, all the way up to midfield. First down.
It was a great play, and I'll tell you, it almost resembled the old Statue of Liberty play almost. And Mike just took the handoff. Now, here's Carl. He goes back, and that's just a draw play is all it was, but it really looked good. But he's all the way up there near the midfield stripe, and that's what you got to have with the momentum maybe building back up here at the end of the first half.
Then stop with a minute 11.
And I believe Marshall wants a timeout. There's a timeout here in the closing moments of the first half. Marshall driving.
Marshall 7, Furman 21. We'll be back for the final minute
of the first half. A moment ago, they rambled off about 30 yards, and they need to put a score on the board here, or at least a field goal.
They do to go in with the momentum on their side, and at least not to,
you know, empty-handed here on this drive.
Football's at the Marshall 49.
We got the green free again.
Marshall
7-0 at the quarter. Furman has scored 3 touchdowns
in the second period. And now Marshall trying to get back in this thing before a full house at Fairfield.
Surratt to the outside, 45.
Sidelines, out of bounds, which will stop the clock around the 42-yard line. Stops the clock with a minute 3. That play took about 8 seconds.
And very alertly, Robert Surratt ran it out of bounds.
What I was going to say, Wade, he knew exactly where he had to go and get out of bounds, stop the clock, and it's a minute 3 to go. There's only a...
Well, about a... Let's see. Let's watch it again here. Here's Robert.
Right there he is. He knows where he has to go, looking for the sidelines, and there he runs out of bounds to stop the clock.
Number 42, Tim.
A freshman had a hand on Surratt. Here is second and one.
Marshall fighting the clock and the Paladins now. Here's Tim Lewis. Boy, they have really checked him, but that time...
In the second quarter, Fodor finds Lewis inside the 30, first down.
Clock stops again. Football's at the 29-yard line. Clock stops so they can move the chains.
21-7, as you can see, 58 seconds remaining. Here
we go. There's plenty of time for Fodor and the Herd to try to strike. Swisher, but it's incomplete. He trapped the ball.
Cut right for Brian Swisher.
At the 15-yard line, I don't know if we'll have a replay. If you see Brian there, he kind of had to go down on his knees to get the football, and it looked from our vantage.
There were three officials. They had him in a triangle, and he was right in the middle of it. And
they say no, sir. Marshall has two timeouts. Now, here it is. Does he have it? I don't know.
50 seconds remaining before halftime.
It would, as we said, just a...
So there's enough time, and...
Things completely around if the Herds could come up with a score here.
At least a field goal away. They have to score here, and if they can get in Scott LaTulip's range here, that'll help them.
But, you know, 21-10 is a long way from 21-7, and...
Maybe they can get things going in the second half.
Number 10, Carl Fodor. There was an interesting story in the
Charleston newspaper this week about Carl Fodor. He was an outstanding baseball
and basketball player in high school, and he went to a couple tryout camps as a pitcher and had a chance to sign a pro
contract with the Cincinnati Reds, but decided to take
over baseball. He's a very, very talented young man.
You know, most quarterbacks are that way. They are, you know, multi-talented, and they could play football, baseball, basketball,
whatever they want to do, and I'm sure Carl's no exception. Mike, in youth baseball, they said he...
Something like 15 no-hitters.
Well, I can see with the arm he's got, I'll tell you.
21-7. Furman leading, and
trying to get on the scoreboard before halftime, 50 seconds to go.
Second and 10. Carl Fodor with time. A great reception by McCoy inside the 20 at about the 17.
18-yard line. Clock stops again as they have to move the chain.
43 seconds remaining. First down, Mark.
Clock is running.
37 seconds remaining. Fodor, end zone.
All right.
Yeah, what a play!
The play in the and if ever there was a
play in the ball game with about 30 seconds to go. We just saw it, and this crowd that has been quieted.
Going bananas again. As Dave Parrish and Brian Swisher just said.
Reunion of the decade. It hasn't been like that here in many, many years. Here's Brian. What a catch. It is. He get leveled there by number 22.
Steve Squire, but it's too late. Brian beat the ball. And it is now 21-13,
and Marshall is back.
Scott LaTulip will try to cut Furman's lead here to 7.
21-13. 33
seconds remaining. Scott LaTulip now has... The extra point standpoint has now made 41 in a row.
There it was again, and perfectly thrown. And Brian Swisher, what a
great athlete he is. Super hands, Carl Fodor, the combination.
Tremendous. We've talked about it all September here, and it just continues on. Marshall had to have it. They got it, and now they're back in the
football game. Brian Swisher, the third touchdown
of the season. And that was the most important one so far because that puts the Herd back in this game.
In the closing half minute of the first half, that's going to give Marshall the impetus.
Going into the locker room, and anything's possible in the second half right now as Scott LaTulip will try to boom it away.
I would anticipate a long kick, but you never know.
Browns got back into this thing. Furman took him out of it, Wade, in about midway through the second quarter, and that's exactly what Marshall can't afford.
They've got to keep this crowd into the football game. They
keep their emotion high, and they've got to play good, smart football. Those are the elements that Stan Perry said they had to have to win a game, and if they can keep that, they can do it. They can play.
There's no doubt about that. A blocked field goal attempt and an interception.
Gave Furman the impetus in the second quarter. They dominated the second quarter going into the last minute or so, but
last 71 seconds, Marshall has turned it around. We've really got a new ball
game. And I tell you, I can't wait for the second half if Marshall can just hold
for 33 seconds. That's right. Get your sandwich
and your drinks ready. The second half's coming up here in a few minutes.
The Stan Parrish aerial circus continues. This is Jaeger. Up the middle. About the 22, 23-yard line, and the clock shows 26 seconds to go. And give this herd so much credit. You know, they came back with a dramatic touchdown last week when Eastern Michigan came back in the game in the second half. And now when Furman's about ready to blow the herd away, you see it's 21-14, 26 seconds to go. And that touchdown drive in just about 71 seconds was, without a doubt, the biggest of the year so far.
Well, they couldn't let Furman score again at any cost, because if they were to go up 28-7, I think a few of these people may leave about the fourth quarter, and they don't want that to happen.
No one's leaving now as Williams up the middle, and you can see the momentum switching back, and that will come after the whistle. Clock is winding down, 16 seconds remaining. Tony Lelly crashing through defensively. Clock is stopped with 16 seconds to go. Marshall's defense, secondary with Leon Sims, Jerome Hazard, Mike Copenhagen, and Garfield Lewis. That's going to do it for the first half. And what a dramatic first half it was as Marshall struck late to get back in the game, and this crowd is right back in it. And anything's possible, as we said, we're looking forward to the second half. It is Marshall 14, Furman 21. We'll be back at Fairfield Stadium in a few moments.
Hear what Tri-State listeners are saying about the Hot FM.
As you can see there, we'll be kicking off for the herd. It's been quite a football game. Marshall led and dominated the first quarter 7-0. Up until the final minute and 10 seconds of the second quarter, it was all Furman. They had tied the game on a four-yard run by fullback Dennis Williams at 7-7. And then Scott LaTulip trying a field goal attempt. It was blocked. And after that blocked field goal attempt, it was all Furman as they scored twice to take a 21-7 lead before Marshall scored in the final seconds. And what a game it is now. 21-14, fumbled at the goal line. Sean McCall on the return. And this Marshall team, you can see, they're fired up here in the second half.
Stan Parrish has to be the guy that's got these people playing the way they are. They came down, this special teams has impressed me ever since they began about three or four games ago, but they are super, super on their downfield pursuit. And it sets up the first and 10 now on the Furman 11.
Well, the Furman team has not made many mistakes, but if they make one, it would really benefit the Marshall cause now, because Furman is all the way down on their 11-yard line. First and 10. One of the few times Furman with very poor position in this ball game. Furman leading 21-14, and they go to Robbie Gardner. And look at Gardner. He's still on his feet. 35-30. Gardner is going all the way for a touchdown. Robbie Gardner, 89 yards to stun the crowd and the Marshall football team. As Marshall came roaring out of here, made a great play on the kickoff, and then Robbie Gardner, the junior 200-pounder, watch him.
Gardner found a hole there, and there he goes, off to the sidelines. Leon Sims has a shot at him there, trying to head tackle, of course, and down the sidelines he goes. Now, we've got one defender. That'll be Palazzetti trying one time there at the four-yard line, but I think a lot of that credit should go to number 74, Bernard Durham. He's one of the offensive tackles that opened up that big hole.
Some 89 yards, his longest before that was a 26-yard run this season. Extra point again by Kevin Esball. And again, Furman, as they did in the second quarter, about ready to run away and hide as they had taken a 21-7 lead, and Marshall fought back to make it 21-14, and we're in the same situation now where Marshall must get this football and move it down and score.
It hasn't changed at all, and Furman used 23 seconds of the clock that time to put a TD and an extra point on the board. And Marshall, as you said, Wade, they must come back now. And they've got to contain Mr. Gardner. He's the guy that they've got to shut down.
I'm sure that had concerned Marshall all week long and Coach Stan Parrish, the explosive potential of this Furman running game with Robbie Gardner and Dinky Williams. And Gardner, who had scored four touchdowns entering this game, that's his second touchdown of the game. He had 82 yards last week. He's been averaging 6 yards a carry. He was the one who had the winning touchdown against the Wolfpack last week. And so let's see now what Marshall can do. Never out of the game, as Carl Foder in the first half, 21 of 34 for 261 yards. Second largest crowd in the history of Fairfield Stadium has just been announced.
It would have been broken, I think, had the seats been still here.
Right around the 18,000 mark. The largest was 18,212 for the Moorhead game in 1981. This one's not over. Let's see if Marshall can come back again, trailing again by two touchdowns. Coker kicks off, and let's see what Abercrombie will do. Now, that definitely was a break for the Paladins, as it bounced out of the end zone, and Marshall will have to go back to work from the 20-yard line. When Abercrombie gets a chance to return it, he usually sets him up around the 30-35-yard line. Foder, 21 completions in the first half of the game. Mike McCoy led the running attack to 5 carries, 41 yards. Swisher with 6 receptions, Abercrombie with 4. They're the favorite targets of Carl Foder. This is Foder. Abercrombie takes the hit up around the 26-yard line. Furman Paladins, undefeated, number one in the NCAA Division I 2A rankings. Marshall, ranked number 11. Furman showing they're for real. They beat North Carolina State last week, and that was no fluke, Mike.
No, it was not, and of course, I think they walloped Newberry, South Carolina, pretty bad, too.
Against North Carolina State, they rushed for 302 yards and passed for 210 yards. So they had 512 yards total offense against the Wolfpack, a major team, of course. Way off the mark. I believe he was trying to find Tim Lewis, and that one, of course, wasn't near Lewis. Lewis had cut in. Apparently, he should have gone out towards the sidelines. As it is, it's a long incomplete pass.
And he was also covered by Carl Moody, the defensive back. A moment ago, Gardner, of course, had 68 yards coming into the second half. Wade, I think you said he picked up 89 on that last. That gives him 157 now for the game.
It's third down for Marshall. Football is at the 26-yard line. And this crowd has become very silent. Third down, needing 4. Marshall needs a first down here. Third and 4 at the 26 of the herd. 28-14. Crow set in the backfield. There's the first down. Abercrombie out to about the 41-yard line. Ben Browder, who had a key interception earlier in this game, a senior, entered with 27 tackles, stopped Abercrombie, but Daddy Abercrombie, who had 4 receptions in the first half, here's a big one, Mike.
Out of the backfield, you see Mike McCoy set up a nice block there to give him some time, and it was too late as Dan's got the first down.
From the Marshall 40, Abercrombie to the right, Lewis to the left. Foder scrambling under pressure, and Surratt makes a tremendous catch up the midfield.
First down, too, I think.
Acrobatic move by Robert Surratt. Rockhurst, Southern Conference Player of the Week, with 27 tackles last week, a senior linebacker. Hurst also dropped ball carriers for losses last week on 6 occasions. Watch this catch.
Carl just let it fly, and Robert Surratt made the catch of the year, I think, and he got about 4 yards after the catch to put it on the 49 now, Furman.
Very gifted, Robert Surratt. You saw a part of this big crowd, second largest, and Fairfield Stadium history. First and 10, football at the 49 of Furman. Early in the third quarter, Furman leading by 2 touchdowns again. There's McCoy at about the 43-yard line. Hurst and Browder, the linebackers, making the play defensively. And Mike McCoy, very talented freshman from Parkersburg. Billy Hines enters the ball game, replacing Brian Swisher. Swisher and Hines alternating at split end. Hines to the right with the flanker Abercrombie. Tight end Tim Lewis, split to the left. Surratt is in the slot, and you have no running back here. Behind Carl Folder on the second down, needing four at the 43 of Furman. Surratt drops the ball, coming out of the backfield. That will bring up a third and four.
Well, everybody knew what that was going to be. They had four or five receivers there, and Surratt just came out of the slot, crossed over the line of scrimmage, and the ball was just dropped. It brings up a third and four now with 12 minutes and 3 seconds left in the third.
As you know, Marshall has never beaten Furman in football, 0-8. Third down from the 43-yard line. Hurd trying to come up with a play here, which will keep this drive alive. Looks like an audible. Abercrombie, first down and more. Near the 20, Danny Abercrombie, number three pass receiver in the Southern Conference, entered this game with 15 receptions and four touchdowns, and he has really been something in this contest.
You know, the thing that's driving the secondary crazy, now watch this, here again is Folder again, and out of the backfield again is Danny Abercrombie there at the 21-yard line, and the secondary's had fits with the Marshall receivers all night long. And Marshall is using, I think, more than anything, a lot of receivers out of the backfield. Surratt, then McCoy, whoever. You know, they can find anybody. Next, of course, was Abercrombie out of the flanker spot.
First and 10, Marshall, 21-yard line of Furman. This is Folder rolling. And this pass is going to be, let's see, incomplete, almost intercepted as it was popped up. The last time something like that happened, there was an interception. Rock Hurst was a key man down there, number 45 for Furman. And that was a bit scary.
Yeah, Marshall gets a real break out of this now here. Carl rolling to his left, looking for his receiver. And the ball's once, look at this, almost had that. And everybody in the place, including Jared Smith there, thought he had it. But it's a second and 10, incompleted pass.
Football at the 21-yard line of Furman. Marshall needs a score again, trailing by two touchdowns, 28-14. A lot of time remaining, third period. Full house here at Fairfield looking on. Folder has time, going deep, and almost intercepted again. Way off the mark. Gerard Smith, number 83, a senior out of Florida, defensive end, almost picked it off, so now it is third down.
Well, I think Swisher may have been the intended receiver that time, as you said, Wade, and Marshall has been very fortunate in the last couple of plays that bobbled the ball a moment ago. This time here, it could have been an interception. So it sets up a third and 10. And for the first time in a long time, Foder has thrown two incomplete passes back to back.
Hines is wide to the left, Lewis to the right, Abercrombie in the slot. Third down, needing 10 at the 21-yard line of the Paladins. Foder with time again over the middle, deflected as it was intended for Lewis, and give that secondary a lot of credit.
That's Ben Browder, I think, number 55, was the man that swatted it down. And like you said, Wade, they have met the challenge here.
Now becomes a fourth down, and Swisher checks in.
How about this? No field goal, babe. It's going to be fourth and 10. Shoot the marble.
They need seven, but right now they'd just be happy to get a first down. They need 10 for a first down, 21 for a touchdown. Fourth down, Swisher to the left with Abercrombie, Lewis to the right. This is the fourth down and 10, and it's incomplete, and the pass, again, a little bit over the head of Robert Surratt. I'm not even sure if he had caught the ball, if it had been enough for a first down, because he could hear footsteps.
He would have needed eight more to get the first down.
The Paladins defense doing the work. Now the pressure really swings to the Marshall defense as on that last series, Robbie Gardner broke it for 89 yards and a touchdown. Marshall cannot allow the Paladins any more touchdowns right now. Staying on the ground. Look at this again. Dinky Williams and the Furman's vaunted running game is really starting to shine.
Yes, it has. They're establishing that game, and you're going to see Dink Williams now just come right up the middle there, follow his blockers right up again, and thank goodness there's a Marshall defender, but it's another first down.
Williams and Gardner ran wild last week against North Carolina State, and we can see why. Well, it's been working, so they try it again. That's Dinky Williams, the junior from Anderson, South Carolina. He's been averaging 6 yards a carry. He scored in the second quarter from 4 yards out, and that touchdown knotted the game. Brian Mays has checked in at linebacker. He's the number one man in tackles so far this season for Marshall. Second and about 7 with the football at the 36-yard line of Furman. Hurd needing a turnover in their favor. The option, and here we go again. Number 21, Greg Smith. He's a sophomore out of Alabama, 193-pounder. He's carried this season 17 times for 74 yards, averaging 4.5 yards a carry. Gardner, Jager, and Smith giving Furman 3 outstanding tailbacks.
Well, Dink Williams that time took out 2 Marshall defenders on that while he turned the corner, and he just put a body block into 2 green shirts, and that's what set that man free.
First down, and Furman really controlling the game.
Uh-oh.
Another tailback. That time is Jager trying to shake off a tackle. Still gets some yardage. Brian Jager. Ethan Fields, senior nose guard, catching up with him. That running game starting to wear down Marshall's defense.
I think it's getting stronger, Wade, as it goes on.
Well, they're doing a lot of substituting, bringing in fresh backs, and they've got depth and talent back there. Bobby Lamb running the show, and here's Smith. That time, the Marshall defense did a job. John Logan, senior out of Lexington.
Now, a couple of more plays like this, John Logan really just pushed people out of the way and got in there and said, hey, come here a minute. And that's exactly what they're going to have here. They're going to have more plays like that one. That sets up a 3rd and 8. Here's the passing situation, maybe.
And again, Marshall needs to stop Furman on this play. 3rd down, needing 8 at the 46-yard line of the herd. Lamb. That's the 1st down to Kirk Burnett. He's a sophomore. He's been averaging 20 yards a reception. Has scored a touchdown out of Columbia, South Carolina. And so the talented Paladins move on.
Now, Burnett was over on the left side. Fox went down the right side in a pattern, but there's the sideline pattern, and Garfield Lewis knocking him out of bounds. Had a couple of people open, really, but that was the man.
Furman controlling the tempo now. Moving the ball well. 1st and 10 at the Marshall 36. That's Gardner. Well, they stopped him that time, but a few minutes ago, 23 seconds deep or so into this third quarter, that young man ran 89 yards for a touchdown that has given Furman a 2-touchdown lead at 28-14 with a little over 8 minutes to go in the third quarter as Jeff Foreman checks in defensively. Second down, 2nd and 8 for the Paladins at Marshall's 34-yard line. Lamb on the option. Gardner again. He's at the 10, the 5, and I believe he stepped out.
It's a good thing, too. All the way back at the 20-yard line is where he stepped out of bounds. And, boy, I'll tell you, he can put some moves on you, change his direction so quickly. And you're going to look at it here. There's the old option out of there. Just watch this move right here. To the right, and there he put two. Look at a nice block there on the end there. Sean McCall did the blocking, but there you go. Back to the 20, and a break for Marshall.
Oh, he is a powerful tailback, 5'9", 200-pounder from Orangeburg, South Carolina, and only a junior. 1st down at the Marshall 20. It's dry. And you know the remarkable thing, Mike, about this running attack, Williams and Gardner and Jager and Dry, they're just juniors and sophomores.
Mm-hmm.
And Greg Smith is a sophomore.
Like you said a minute ago, they do have the depth, and they're running these people in and out, and this running game, I suspect, is getting somewhat stronger here.
Very few seniors on this Furman team. Here's second down, needing six at the 16 of Marshall. Long count here by Bobby Lamb. Second down play, Lamb plenty of time. And we got a flag. Leon Sims defending.
Wade, I think that may be a little bit of frustration on Leon's part because Fox has beaten him twice tonight, and you're going to look at it again here. Lamb's looking for Fox all the way. Right over the middle he goes, and of course, Leon, a good call by the official, I think. And
Sims all over him.
He sure was. And Leon's a little bit frustrated, and it's going to set up now a first down on the five-yard line.
Alan Huff checks back in defensively.
Maybe the four.
So it'll be first and goal. Football about the three-yard line. Just under 8 minutes to go in the third quarter. John Dry, that's a touchdown for the Paladins. John Dry's a junior. He's the backup to Dinky Williams. That'll be his first touchdown of the season. And the Paladins lead, ballooning now, 34-14, midway through the third quarter.
There was John Dry you talked about plunging over, and that's the one that puts him up by 20. And of course, coming up here right now is Kevin Esvall. He was going to try to add the extra point to make it 35-14 if he can. And he does.
It is now Furman, 35, Marshall, 14, and now we'll really see what Marshall can do. And this Furman running game, and they've got great depth.
Oh, they simply do, like the people you mentioned a moment ago. And it's still plenty of time. There's 7 minutes and 37 seconds left here in the third period, and lots of things can happen, but Marshall right now is simply going to have to, you know, eliminate their mistakes and get into this thing and to get some kind of a drive going. You know, they must score on this set. They've got to do that.
Well, it's quite a contrast. You've got Marshall, the one-dimensional offense with the passing game, and it has worked so well going into this game, but then you've got look at Furman with the balance attack, tremendous strength and depth in the backfield, and then Bobby Lamb, a 60% passer, so that really gives Furman that extra dimension.
It sure does. They complement each other, no question about that. And we're going to find out now what we've got. We've got Danny Abercrombie back at about the one, and he'll be the deep man. And it's going to be too much to ask for a run back. Huh?
Tom Coker's been busy kicking off. Danny Abercrombie, he gets a chance to return it, has been averaging close to 30 yards on a return. Marshall dominated the first quarter 7-0, but since then it's been catch up. Go all the way back to the second quarter, and again it was that attempted field goal that was blocked, and since then it just hasn't been the same Marshall team, and it's been pretty much all Furman, even though Marshall made a great run at him to close within a touchdown at halftime. Abercrombie trying to break it. This is Abercrombie, 30, 35, 40, Abercrombie at midfield, dragged down by a jersey, and that might just ignite the herd again. What a tremendous return by Mr. Excitement, Daddy Abercrombie.
Yeah, I was saying, could it be possible that he'd run one back? Well, we got half of what they were hoping for. He got 50-yard return on that. If Marshall has excellent possession out the 50-yard, and let's watch this thing. It's a thing of beauty. They find these wedge right about here. Finds that hole. He's going to cut back to his right and take a block there, and he goes on over to the sidelines. And good thing for Furman that Sean McCall was there to bring him down.
First down, Marshall, 49-yard line of Furman. This game is not over. There's still a lot of time to go, and problems offensively, and Carl Fodor says, let's take a timeout. So we've got a timeout on the field with the score. Furman 35, Marshall 14. We'll be back at Fairfield Stadium in just a moment. We're looking forward to returning here for our telecast on Saturday, October 13th. It'll be Marshall against Appalachian State at Fairfield Stadium, and that'll be an afternoon contest at 1:30, and we'll have it for you on Channel 61 Saturday night. at 10 o'clock, Marshall and Appalachian State. Next week again, Marshall on the road. First road game, first afternoon game at Western Michigan. Inus and Abercrombie to the left on first and 10 at the 49 of Furman. Surratt off the right side, and he dives from extra yardage to about the 41-yard line.
Number five, Robert.
Nothing more than the old conventional pitch out, and as you say, that second effort there got about 6 or 7 yards on the play, and they are comfortably now into Furman territory. Second down and 3:07:05 to go.
Football spotted at the 42-yard line of the Paladins. Swisher to the left. Abercrombie in the slot. Tim Lewis to the right, split out. Surratt off the right side, and he slices through to about the 38-yard line, and that should be a first down.
It's the 18th of the game for Marshall.
Number 15, Pop makes the tackle.
Before the football game, Carl Foder, passing-wise, is 26 out of 35. At one time, though, Wade, in the quarter here so far, was 5 out of 11, which is very uncharacteristic of him.
You saw the clock a moment ago, less than 7 minutes to go, third quarter. First and 10 at the Furman 38. Boulder in traffic. Hines, 20, near the 19-yard line. Billy Hines, the senior out of Huntington. He is stopped by Cliff Barfield, but a big play, and the Herd knocking on the door as the ball is being spotted at the 20. Watch Huntington's Billy Hines.
Here's Bill now running a nice pattern. When Bill comes into the game, he always makes a big play, seems like. He's a big play guy, and he comes in, sets up another first down, the 19th of the game, and another completion. It sets it up on the 20-yard line, and Marshall's on the move.
Still a lot of time to go. Third quarter, 6 minutes remaining. Swisher to the right, Lewis to the left. First and 10 at the Furman 20. Boulder. It is Abercrombie near the five. Danny Abercrombie, who caught five or four passes in the first half, has just been outstanding here in the third quarter. It was his return of the kickoff that ignited Marshall again, and now it's going to be goal to go for the Herd. Watch it here to Abercrombie.
Here's the second key reception in this drive, and Danny Abercrombie down about the 6 or 7 yard line. Another reception and sets it up first down on the 6, they give it.
Bristol off the right side, cuts into about the 2 yard line. Rockhurst and Tim Stepp catching up with Tim Bristol, the sophomore.
Stepp makes the tackle at the 3 yard line. It's second and goal.
Marshall will set it up on the 3 yard line down, second down with 5:13 to go.
Marshall has made some changes. They have moved in a couple offensive men as blocking backs, trying to stay on the ground. Bristol isn't going anywhere against this tough Furman defense.
Well, number 55, Ben Browder, one of the linebackers, I think has played an excellent football game. He's been everywhere, and that time was a very key defender in that tackle.
You saw some unusual numbers. Mike Arrakis, a guard, and Sam Manos, a center, moved into the backfield to add strength as blocking backs on close yardage, but it didn't work. And it looks like Ken Conway, the senior tight end, has moved in off the left side. We go back now to that I formation, and here's a big third down needing four, and Foder looking for someone. Foder is scrambling, still scrambling, throws in the end zone. Touchdown to Tim Lewis! And you never count out Stan Parrish and the Marshall Herd as they fell behind, and now they have made a ball game of it again.
Well, Tim Lewis beat Carl Moody, the defensive back, and Carl Foder had about 3 years to throw the football. He went back in the pocket then. We'll probably see it here again. Here it is. And Carl goes back. Now look at this. He has all day, and the secondary is moving all over the place. Carl finally finds Lewis moving to his right there at the end zone, and it's a great reception, a great throw. He led him just perfectly enough for the catch.
Boy, give the Herd credit as they come fighting back. They're not going to give up. Talk about intestinal fortitude. Quite a rush there. That extra point is good. We're going to keep it right here, Mike, because it's 35-21, and each time it looks like Marshall is gone. Looks like Furman's going to close the door. The Herd on the arm of Carl Foder, staying very much in this ballgame. And, you know, it only takes a couple passes by Foder, and Marshall has struck again, and we've got a lot of football ahead.
That's exactly right, Wade, because when you get into this type of situation here, you take away the 89-yard touchdown run that Gardner had at the outset of the third quarter. This thing would have been completely different than what it is right now. Marshall would have been only a touchdown away. However, they are two now, and there's still plenty of time, 4:22, and we're in the third period of play. Still plenty of time, so get another sandwich, get yourself something to drink, and hang around. It ain't over yet.
Again, I would say it would be very important for Marshall's defense to stop Furman on this particular series. They haven't been able to do it so far here in the third quarter. Give the Hurt so much credit as Gardner racing 89 yards for a touchdown. And, you know, a few years ago or last season or whatever, that just about would have broken the backs of a Marshall football team. But this is a Marshall football team under Stan Parrish, and they have been able to overcome adversity, and they've been able to fight back. And down 35-14, it's 35-21, and they're right back in it with them two touchdowns again.
Kind of reminds you of the NFL, doesn't it, huh? These high-scoring games like this.
Basketball, too.
Well, I think, if I remember right, in my reading the brochure a moment ago, Furman averages about 38 points a ball game, and Marshall 32 coming into this. Well, he's going to have to eat it there. He better.
Number 34, Brian Jaeger, as Scott LaTulip delivering a fine kickoff. And now let's see if the Hurt can slow down what has been just an explosive ground attack here in the third quarter, led by Dennis Williams and Robbie Gardner, and with some very, very talented backup people.
Wade, you had talked about the temperature being in the 80s or 90s when we began the game. I think the temperature dropped somewhat. It's down in the mid-70s now, and a lot cooler than it was about an hour and a half ago.
This crowd now coming alive because they realize if Marshall can hold them here and score again, anything's possible. This is Dinky Williams across the 25, 26, 27. So far, the Furman running game has been unstoppable here in the third quarter or second half.
It has been that. And, you know, they're just opening up gigantic holes in there. And Williams and Gardner are just flying right behind the guys that are opening it up, following their blocker through that hole. A 7-yard gain sets up a second and three, just under 4 minutes to go.
From the 27-yard line to the Paladins on this second and three. Lamb, the quarterback. Williams looks like he has another Furman first down.
That should be their 16th of the ball game.
That defensive alignment. John Logan's 89. Daryl Johnson, Jeff Borman, Ethan Fields, Alan Huff, Marty Palazzetti digging in, trying to find some way to contain Furman on the ground. Nice option by Lamb, close to the 40-yard line. Bobby Lamb, extremely talented quarterback. He's just a junior out of Commerce, Georgia.
The thing I like about him, Wayne, he's so deceptive with and smooth, as I think as you said it. He can pass the football with his accuracy here, 60% most of the time. And you're going to watch him down, just fake the handoff and fake number 46 out there. And doggone, he's into an, almost a first down.
Marshall made a couple more changes defensively, trying to find a combination to stop him. This is second and needing about three for a first down at the 39 of Furman. Lamb. He really took that time back at the 32-yard line, and that's one way to stop him.
Yes, sir, and the man that did it is number 86, I think it is. That's Daryl Johnson. I've got to start tonight. Watch this. Watch these arms go up here.
This is
come here,
man, out of Louisville.
Yes.
Daryl Johnson opening at the defensive end, and they move Tony Lelly to a linebacker slot.
Yeah, it's a third and nine. Watch the crowd get into this now.
This is the play that Marshall needs defensively and to force Furman to give up the football late here in the third quarter. Lamb will throw under some pressure. Incomplete, and Marshall's defense has done it. They have finally stopped Furman, and Marshall will get the ball down by two touchdowns with 1:50 to go. Third quarter, and this crowd is back in it again.
And two people that put the pressure on him was Jeff Borman and, of course, Jerome Hazard. They are the guys that applied the defensive pressure. They're the ones that made him throw the football before he wanted to. He was underthrown. And now Marshall has the football coming their way. Let's see what they can do.
Hamilton is back. Burgess is back. Burgess and Lewis. They're going to just let it bounce, and it's a short kick. Now it gets a favorable roll, but one of the few weak spots, if there is a weak spot, is that punting game. Hamilton has replaced the regular punter, James Brown, because of injury. And Marshall has good field position, and this crowd knows that a touchdown here would really put them back in the game now.
It sure will. They'll have the football first and 10 on their own 35. Here comes Carl Foder out now, as you look at the crowd. And Carl's got his instructions from Stan Parrish, and let's see what bag of tricks now they've got up their sleeve.
In the first half alone, Foder completed 21 of 34 passes.
It's 29 out of 38 so far.
First down, Marshall, down by only two touchdowns. We say only because they keep fighting back. Surratt, Robert Surratt. In the first game, Foder threw 42 passes. 38 in the second game. Last week, threw 49. He's averaging 43 passes. In three games, he's thrown 129 passes. And here's another one here.
Here's Robert, kind of slipping there on the carpet a little bit. Would have had maybe three or four more yards, but it sets up a second and six. A minute 11 to go. Marshall trailing by a couple of TDs.
From the Marshall, we'll make it about 38-yard line. Second down play. Foder. Nice reception, but short of a first down by Mike McCoy.
And we've got a flag wave at the 41.
In the first half alone, another penalty. It's really hurt the herd. Marshall penalized for 46 yards in the first half, and here's another costly penalty.
Yes, it is, and it is a holding penalty now. You're going to see another reception here. Carl just out in the nice catch by Mike McCoy. There's Stan Parrish, Brian Swisher there next to him.
Less than a minute remaining in the third quarter. Marshall, 35. Furman, correction, Marshall, 21. Furman, 35. Wishful thinking there, Mike.
Yeah.
Brian Swisher checking in, replacing Billy Hines with a play. 35-21. Furman leading by two touchdowns. Final moments of the third period, and it's now second down and long. Second and about 17. Uh-oh, interception. There is Rockhurst. 20, 15, and inside the 15-yard line goes the Southern Conference Player of the Week, the senior out of Knoxville, Tennessee. Last week, 27 tackles, and this one really hurts.
Well, Carl went back to throw it. Now, you're going to see Lockhurst come right in front of Cam Lewis, and he's going to run it back here. And number 65 for Marshall there, and that is Steve Staley, really put the saving, you know, hit right there. But they've got great field positions around the 19-yard line.
So
another turnover.
Final seconds of the third quarter. Again, Furman is about ready to take a comfortable lead. Already leading 35-21. And the turnovers have just come back to haunt the herd throughout this contest. Lamb, the quarterback. He goes to his fullback. Dinky Williams gets around the 10. Waiting moments. Clock winding down.
What about the 10?
About 8 seconds here. Ejected Carl Foder. That is the end of the third quarter here at Fairfield Stadium in this battle of unbeaten, nationally ranked Southern Conference powers. The score after three quarters at Fairfield Stadium: Marshall 21, Furman 35. We'll be back for the fourth quarter in a moment.
They'll take Moorhead on at 1 o'clock for doubleheader, then play UK at Lexington the next day on Saturday at 1.
Furman facing second down, needing five for a first down. And this is Jaeger off the right side, short of a first down. He drives inside the 10, close to about the six-yard line. Ryan Jaeger, the sophomore tailback in place of starter Robbie Gardner. They're marking the football about the seven-yard line. It'll now be third down.
Third down.
Third and about two.
A ball at the seven.
Two for a first down and seven for a touchdown. First minute of the fourth quarter with Furman on top by two touchdowns. Third and two. On the ground again. Twisting and turning, and it may be a first down Jager, for Brian Jager and the Furman Paladins.
Tackled by Logan for 89.
Good running game. They just keep putting those running backs back in from time to time. And
first down.
It is another first down, as we said. That's the 17th now for them in the ballgame.
Number 34, Brian Jager, a sophomore. He had scored twice entering this game. Defensively, Sean Finnan, a freshman from Ohio near the Cleveland area. Checking back in for Marshall. It's first and goal at the three.
There's a fumble in the end zone. Could be a big break. I believe Marshall has recovered. It'll be a touchback. What a tremendous break. Williams had a touchdown. And this game is not over yet.
Not yet. And, well, you know...
That's the second time a remarkable play. It looked like earlier when Gardner was going for a touchdown, he fumbled the ball.
Yeah, here it is. You're going to see Williams there. The ball is loose, and there's Marty Falazetti to jump right on it. And what a break. The break of the night goes to Marshall right here with 13:40 to go. We've got an eternity to play.
That second time in this game, a fumble by Furman has denied the Paladins a touchdown, and the Herd with a tremendous opportunity. 35-21, plenty of time to go, fourth quarter, and no one's left yet. I think they were thinking about it, but that fumble and the touchback, moving the ball out to the 20.
The time of possession in the third quarter was 7:49 for Marshall, 7:11 for Furman, just about virtually even there, as you can see.
Marshall has proved one thing, that they are not going to give up this season.
Well, you've got two completely contrasting philosophies in football. Of course, Dick Sheridan with his power running game, the ball control type of offense. And then you come in with Stan Parrish with his wide open offense and catch me if you can kind of a thing. And that's exactly what you've got here.
With the timeout, we can kind of look back on this game, and you need a computer to... to keep up with it, because after a 7-0 first quarter, Furman led at halftime as the second quarter, both teams exploding, but Furman scored three touchdowns in the second quarter, led 21-7 before Marshall got on the board in the final minute of the second quarter to make it a 21-14 game at halftime. Again, if you joined us late, it was that blocked field goal attempt in the second quarter that turned it around, and Furman had tremendous momentum, scored a couple touchdowns after that before a 16-yard touchdown pass to Swisher put Furman or Marshall back in the game at halftime. Furman came out in the third quarter and in just a few seconds scored on that 98-yard run by Robbie Gardner, but Marshall battled back again. Touchdown pass to Tim Lewis made it... 35-21, and then just a moment ago when Furman was about ready to put it out of reach, the fumble, and new life for Marshall. Here we go. With over 13 minutes to go. A little draw play, and that won't work to Mike McCoy. They've tried that a couple times with success, but it didn't fool the Paladins that time.
No, they were very, very patient, I think, in waiting that time. They didn't get fooled at all, and Mike, before he could get off of the line of scrimmage, was smothered there at about the 16.
Second and 14.
Marshall scoring, touchdown pass of 14 yards to Abercrombie, 16 yards to Swisher, some 4 yards to Timmy Lewis. A little confusion here. Carl Folder saying something to one of the officials. The penalties and the turnovers plaguing Marshall ever since that second quarter. And against a Furman team, they do not make many mistakes. And they take advantage of the other team's mistakes.
That's right. Well, we had a change in footballs there, something you don't see a lot except maybe when you're playing in the mud. You know.
Let's hope it's a lucky football for Carl Fodor and the herd here. 13 minutes to go in the game. Marshall still very much in it. That's a Swisher twisting away from one tackler and gets all the way out to the 28-yard line. That second effort by the young man from Sistersville, a junior, Brian Swisher. He had 9 receptions and 2 touchdowns entering the game. He has caught 1 touchdown pass in this one.
Here's the sideline pattern. Brian right on there, hits once and twice and knocked out of bounds. Spins, but we're up near the first down marker, making about 3rd down and 2.
42 for Furman there was freshman Tim Stepp. 3rd and 2. Fodor rolls left. And incomplete, almost intercepted, intended for Abercrombie. Slid out of his arms, and for a moment it looked like it might be a pallid interception. That means 4th down, and that means the Thundering Herd will have to give it up.
Yeah, they stalled out that time, but that'll bring on Salmon, of course, with a 4th and 2. 12:18 to go. Marshall, if you're just joining us now, trailing 35-21. And Furman will have the ball.
Mike Salmons. The ever-dangerous Chaz Fox to the outside. Look at Fox roll. 50-45. Oh, they really set up a wall for him, and I believe it was Salmons who might have saved even a longer gain by Chaz Fox. Boy, he is explosive.
Yeah, and he had a lot of help from Mark Cagle on the specialty that time. He threw a key block to set him free around that right end. And, of course, they'll have great field position here. So they get a 1st and 10 inside the 45.
A little over 12 minutes to play. Furman leading 35-21. And, again, the herd needing a break, needing to get that football back. Williams up the middle. He drags Garfield Lewis inside the 35, near the 31. Garfield Lewis, the junior from Lexington. That just shows you the power of that Furman, literally powerful running game.
Yeah, 4 or 5 green shirts were on him that time. But, you know, Marshall really needed to score that last drive there because they needed to take advantage of that tremendous break they had a moment ago on the touchback and the fumble in the end zone. So they need to get the ball right now. The clock becoming almost a factor here. It's 12:13 to go. So we're going to have a measurement here. What's it going to be?
Arkansas beat Tulsa 18-9.
It's a first down for the Paladins.
They're 18th of the game.
Furman's tremendous success. 5 conference titles in the last 6 years. We mentioned this a moment ago, and one of the big reasons they do not make many mistakes.
Almost a dynasty.
Keep looking for maybe a turnover, an interception. They have fumbled the ball a couple of times, and Marshall getting a couple breaks to stay in the football game. But ironically, the fumble is occurring when Furman's just about ready to score. Gardner drags a ball player or two, including
number
Alan Huff, a tackler, defensive tackle, senior 6'4 with him.
I would say Gardner's up around the 200-yard mark now, or close to it, maybe 185, 95. And he's the man that they go to get the 3, 4, 5 yards. As I said, we've said it 2 or 3 times, he averages about 6 yards a carry, so he's the man.
Some unhappy faces now.
Very solemn crowd.
This is 2nd down. Football at the 27-yard line of Marshall. Little movement there.
Nobody called it, though.
And Bobby Lamb says, let's take a timeout, save 5 yards. And
everybody in Fairfield, about 18,000, saw that. But the officials say no. Now watch this. Watch one of the backs there move. There it is. There he is.
Interesting.
Very, very interesting.
Especially with all the penalties going against Marshall tonight.
Final score, Washington 35.
In the Southern Conference, Western Carolina beat VMI today, 22-16. Pretty good
final
game
score,
for VMI.
Yes, sure
Appalachian
was.
State,
against one of the powers.
14, East Tennessee State.
John Rogan checking back in.
The Kentucky game was Kentucky beat Tulane 30-26. We mentioned that Maryland upended WVU.
Hasn't been a good day for Mountain State fans from Morgantown to Huntington. 11 minutes plus remaining. Football is at the 27-yard line of Marshall. Drummond leading 35-21. 21-14 was the halftime score.
Wait while we have this lull of the action here. You know, we talked about Marshall being number 11, Furman number 1. A lot of people wondering maybe who's number 2, 3, or 4. McNeese State in Louisiana is number 2, Indiana State number 3.
Now we're set to go on 2nd and 5. Marshall's defense rising to the occasion here. And the ball is going to be back around the 30-yard line, and now it is third down.
There we were talking about Indiana State, number 3, Northeast Louisiana, number 4, Holy Cross, 5, Bury State down in Kentucky there, number 6, Boston U, 7, William and Mary, 8, Delaware State, 9, Tennessee State, number 10.
Here is third down, 3rd and 8. Rick Smith is in the backfield, number 21 for Furman. He's a sophomore, long count, and a penalty flag. Maybe a delay here.
Yeah, that'll set up if it's against Furman. I'm sure it is delay. Nope, illegal procedure against them. It's 5 yards in the air. That'll set up a 3rd and 13.
Against Furman.
Also got to concern yourself about a field goal with 11 minutes plus remaining. Furman leading by 2 touchdowns. Marshall not only needs to get the football, but keep Furman out of field goal range. And now it's 3rd down, 3rd and 13 at the Marshall 35 as Chaz Fox comes out to the left. I formation, Bobby Lamb the quarterback. 3rd and long. Bobby Lamb in a passing situation on 3rd and long. He's looking for Fox, who's in the open, and that will be, I believe, a 1st down. Chaz Fox.
The Fox, number 20. 1st down for Furman.
Well, Fox ran his pattern. He came down just a little curl to the left there on a sideline pattern, and you're going to find him here wide open, and Leon Sims there right behind him about 10 or 12 feet, and also there Jerome Hazard in the vicinity, but it's a reception at a 1st down.
It makes it so difficult. You finally stop the running game of Furman, then they come up with the pass, and you've got Bobby Lamb, who completes 60% of his passes. Doesn't throw that often, but when he does, he is very difficult to stop. 1st down, 15-yard line. On the ground, it is Brian Jager. You've got to worry about the run and the pass when you play the Paladins of Furman, and that's why they're undefeated, ranked number 1. One of the big reasons for their big win over North Carolina State last week. Last week, it was 34-30, and this week, it's 35-21. Furman leading with a little over 10 minutes to play.
Wade, they're averaging up around 40 points a ball game, and they're knocking on the door here right again.
2nd and 9 at the 14-yard line of the herd, and this is Jager, the tailback, to about the 10, short of a 1st down. Tony Lely, senior linebacker, out of Weirton.
Jager, number 34,
taking the stop.
Huff, number 98.
Well, the crowd hasn't left yet. There's still plenty of people here.
3rd down.
With the football at the 10-yard line, it is 3rd down. Again, the very dangerous number 20, Chaz Fox, is to the left. Number 78 on the sidelines a moment ago was Ethan Fields. 2nd and 5 at the Marshall 10. Approaching the 9-minute mark in the ballgame. Play in the 4th quarter. Lamb to the end zone to Fox. And he can't hold on to it that time. In the corner of the end zone, perfectly thrown pass.
4th down.
Well, a couple fumbles, and then that pass there, and
number 7.
Marshall still in the game, but
we're
anticipating a field goal attempt here by Kevin Espall on field goals, 2 of 4 against North Carolina State. Last week he kicked 2, getting one from 32 yards out, the other from 21. Anyway, here's a kick of some 27 yards. Boy, he's got the distance. And that is good. So a field goal of 28 yards is good. That puts Furman in front now, 38-21.
Well, no doubt about it. They are a very, very powerful football team, and a lot of weapons there, as you mentioned, the running backs, and then, of course, Jazz Fox, and then the guy coming off of the bench there, Esval, with a what a foot he has. So Marshall now has found themselves trailing by 17, 38-21. There's 9 minutes and 14 seconds left in the football game. So Marshall's got a lot of work to do. They can't afford to turn the football over. They must score now on every opportunity. And back deep, of course, will be number 27, Danny Abercrombie. And Keith Baxter will be back there along with Robert Surratt.
Bourbon scored 28 in the first win over South Carolina State, exploded against Newberry, 49 points, and then 34 points against North Carolina State last week. And they put 38 points on the board here, leading 38-21. That field goal, the first score of the fourth quarter. Tom Coker will be kicking off.
It always amazed me, Wade, these kickers, how they kick barefooted. I know they kick it off of the instep here, but doggone, it looks like it's going to hurt.
Number 11, Coker will kick off. 27.
Second largest crowd in Fairfield Stadium history. Just short of the 18,212 here for the Morehead State game in 1981. They've seen an offensive show. Berman Paladin so far have lived up to their number one ranking and domination of the Southern Conference over the last 6 years or so. Keith Baxter slid out for a few extra yards to about the 23-yard line. Baxter's a freshman from Miami, Florida, number six.
Baxter,
there he is, almost
six.
Lost the jersey.
With a kickoff return.
Well, Keith, as you say, did get a few yards up over what he thought he might have got. He's up to the 22-yard line. A Marshall now. We'll set up camp there at 9:08 to go.
Football at the 22-yard line.
I've been right here. I had a guy up here ready to go, and then go.
38-21. Score. Bourbon out on top. He just joined us now.
The field goal has sent a few people for the exits. But don't give up on Marshall yet. 9 minutes plus. Swisher and Abercrombie play to the left. Lewis to the right. First and 10 at the Herd 22. Boulder in trouble, but Abercrombie makes a great catch in traffic all the way out to the 40-yard line.
It was a good catch, and of course, Carl was pressured that time quite a lot. And he was lucky to get the football away. Here's the replay on it. Now watch all the pressure he's got. They've got a hold of him there, and he just lets loose at the last possible second up around the 40-yard line.
Abercrombie has had a tremendous night catching the football.
Another first down for Marshall. That's their 22nd of the game.
Football at the Marshall, 39. Just under 9 minutes to play in the game now. Sideline pass, and Surratt diving, but it's incomplete. And let's go to the sidelines here, and we've got George Conley standing by.
Pass over, man.
Intended for Surratt.
All right, fans, and here for 20 years, a man who's retired now, but a big Green fan by way of Marshall and class of what, I don't know. But Walter, 41. Now, what do you think of this big Green tonight?
Oh, they're great. They're great. They're great.
Do you mind staying here and deferring your trip south to watch the big Green play some football?
Not a bit. It's very encouraging.
All right, Walter. Very good now. That's the kind of fans you've got here with the big Green thundering herd. Back up, Wade.
Thank you, George. And here is Fodor throwing over the middle. Abercrombie makes a great catch again with a trio of defenders around him at the 40-yard line of the Berman Paladins.
Just a circus catch by Danny. Like you said, Wade, there was triple coverage on him at the 41-yard line. And again, Carl, that accuracy again, right over the middle, and the circus had to reach out and grab it and bring it back. But it's another first down, the 23rd.
Abercrombie had 15 receptions entering the game, the number three receiver in the Southern Conference, and he has had a tremendous night.
He sure has. And with 8:21 to go, Marshall's on the move now. They're in Furman territory.
He's also scored a touchdown, the first touchdown of the game. First down play, a little draw play, but not much room for McCoy. That play has not worked the last couple times. And Eddie Bopp, the nose guard junior from Florida, 225-pounder, number 50, entered this game with 23 tackles. made the stop on the core. They've got that well defense now.
Yeah, they're waiting for that one there. That hadn't got anybody fooled, I don't think. And with third down and 11, here's another obvious passing down. Let's see what happens here. Who's it going to be?
Football about the 42-yard line of the Paladins, third and long.
Tim Lewis, I bet.
Porter has time, and it is going to be Swisher. Brian Swisher, let's see. It's going to be close to a first down. That's going to depend on where they mark the football. Someone lost a shoe, number 40, Robert Little.
Here's Brian again, and you're going to see him just come right back and get the football. And you saw the shoe there that flipped out, but it should be close to the first down. We'll measure to find out.
It's been an awfully good night for Brian Swisher, too, on the receiving end.
Marshall, just, you know, like we said a moment ago and throughout the game so far, it is a first down, I think. And it's just a super, you know, array of receivers, but they're beating a good football team, and they've proven why they're number one.
The amazing thing, it's a very young Furman football team. As we said earlier, only about five seniors are starters, only nine seniors on the squad. That's amazing. Here's first down from the 32 of Furman. Boulder with time. He's throwing deep, and it's knocked away. And Jennifer Lewis, we've got interference against Robert Little, the sophomore from Greensboro. And I believe the Herd will finally get a break.
Yeah, they sure will. And you're going to find this one here. I hope they get a shot of this one here. But Carl went back and found his receiver. Here it is now. And you're going to see the interference call here in a moment. Had a year and a half to throw the ball. And here it is right in front of him over the shoulder. And Tim Lewis said, yeah, you hit me.
And so it'll be first down. Everything holds up right as they're marking it down around the 17-yard line. Should be first down. First down for Marshall. 17-yard line of the Paladins. Still over 7 minutes to play. 38-21. Furman leading. Furman led at halftime, 21-14. Swisher is wide to the right, Abercrombie to the left, I formation, McCoy and Surratt the running backs. Carl Fodor has gone all the way at quarterback. In the end zone, it is Abercrombie for the touchdown.
Beautiful.
Danny Abercrombie, who we've fed several times, has had a great night. That is his second touchdown pass. And, you know, if we had to have a star of the game, I wouldn't hesitate to say Danny Abercrombie has been the star of this game for Marshall.
Oh, he's got great, great concentration, great hands. And you're going to watch him run down the sideline here. 20 yards, he's going to run it and spread out and beat his man. Now, here he goes. Look at this. Watch him. Got cut, beat number 40. Right there he goes. And that little move he put right there on Fox is the man, the number 40, I'm sorry, Robert Little is the guy that he beat.
You know, we've said this several times tonight. This game still isn't over.
No.
It's not decided yet.
Not yet.
Extra point, a very important extra point is good. And now that puts Marshall within 10 points with 7 minutes to go. Here's the touchdown. Watch it.
Let's do it again here now. There's from another angle, you see. And beautiful, beautiful catch by Danny Abercrombie. And it's, as you said, Wade, it's now only 10 points, and there's still plenty of time, 7:03.
What is that now? 666 points, am I right, in this one?
Yeah, uh-huh. That's a lot of points. Like I said, it's the NFL.
It's been fun.
Yes, it has. If you stayed home, fans, you missed it, I'll tell you. You missed a super, super bunch of football players here, college at its best. And you better get out and see these guys play.
Well, Marshall has scored 28 points against the number one ranking team in the nation, the Furman Paladins. Unfortunately, Furman has scored 38, but with 7 minutes to go, the fireworks continue at Fairfield Stadium. And with the score 38-28.